Britain's finest unit for forensic investigation is embarking on a new and groundbreaking mission. They're experts in human identification using the full arsenal of modern technology. But now, for the first time, they're applying these skills to bodies from the long distant past.
It's very exciting for us to be able to take the skills that we use on a daily basis and apply them to look at historical skeletons to see just how far we can go.
Forensic anthropology, facial reconstruction, and painstaking research will open new windows on history as dramatic personal stories emerge from long forgotten bones.
Historical research is allowing me to investigate people's experiences at different times throughout history.
He certainly had a nasty crack to the top of his head.
That must have been so painful.
So we've got the face, the facial reconstruction, and we've added some textures.
Yeah. Fantastic. Yeah. That is just superb.
This time, the cold case team is heading back into a dark corner of the 19th century, when corpses were turned into trophies and children were sold by the inch.
This is just really horrible.
Yes.
Their subject, the strange mummified skeleton of a child. Its brain has been removed, its blood vessels filled with wax. A child who deserved a better fate. Can they give him back a home, a face, a name? This is History Cold Case. The Centre for Anatomy and Human Identification, part of the University of Dundee. The forensic unit is about to take on a challenging new case surrounding an extraordinary set of human remains, the mummified skeleton of a child. Its identity is a mystery. For Professor Sue Black, leader of the cold case team, this is much more than just a set of bones. It's the start of the story. With her colleague, Dr. Xanthi Mallet, she begins with the first observation of the body.
Boy to look at.
Isn't he lovely?
He's beautiful.
The skeleton was donated by a colleague. Sue thinks it's over 100 years old and is some sort of anatomical specimen, dissected for the purposes of display.
A very good friend said, you know, I brought you a present. And I thought, well, you know, chocolates would have been nice.
Whiskey,
you know,
would have been nicer.
Champagne would have been fine, but, you know, this is what we get as a present. Probably a little boy, somewhere around about 8. And I have to say, I've never seen anything like it before.
No.
I really haven't.
No.
To transform the body, the top half of the skull has been sawn off and the chest prized open to remove internal organs. But some of the blood vessels are still preserved, carefully filled with a waxy resin.
Is he naturally mummified?
No, I don't think so. Because what you can, if you can see, these red bits that are sort of poking out here, these are resin. And this is a process that's called perfusion, where you place a substance into a vessel to make it stand out so that you can see it.
Until well into the 19th century, anatomists and surgeons commonly dissected and preserved human bodies as part of their training.
Okay, so that's
a specimen like this one could have been used as a teaching aid.
But look at the cross, look at the flow and the line of that.
Yeah.
They're very artistic. And when you hold them, lift them up, it's really quite...
It's pretty solid, isn't it?
Well, it is, but it's really rather impressive that that's how he would be hanging, looking like that.
Sue never forgets that her subjects were once living people.
There is a sadness in the case. There is no doubting there is a sadness. This was somebody's son. This little boy did have a mum. Whether he had a dad at home or not, we don't know, but he certainly would have had some family. But did anybody care enough when this happened to him? We don't know. I need to know who he is. I need to find that out. He needs that respect.
The initial examination confirms only the basic facts. He's a boy, probably around 8 years old. But can the cold case team discover anything about who he was, where he came from, when he lived, and of course, how he came to be hanging on a wall as some macabre display? Sue calls the first briefing.
This is what's been rather affectionately become known as the problem child of our department. So it's a little boy between 6 and 8.
Dr. Wolfram Meyer-Augenstein will hunt for chemical signatures in the boy's bones, which could reveal information about where he lived and what kind of life he had. Dr. Caroline Wilkinson will perform the important task of giving the boy back his face.
Is there enough face there for you to...
Yeah.
Do something okay. with.
Yeah.
Yeah? What about the fact that there's still some soft tissue on a nose and his ears are still there?
Yeah.
Oh, are they?
You can see one of the... Yeah.
They're really
You can see one of the blood vessels.
Sue thinks the red wax found in the boy's blood vessels could provide crucial physical clues in the case.
This resin, this wax, when you mould it, so if you take a little bit out, you put it in your fingers and you smell it. My father was a cabinet maker. So constant smell of linseed oil and waxes and those sorts of things. That's it smells like the inside of my father's furniture van. So it must be oils or wax of some kind.
Xanthi's task is to get out on the road, to gather evidence from historical records and experts in other fields, starting with the history of anatomy.
But where do you get a 7-year-old, 8-year-old boy from? At what point in history have we got access to children that we could do that to? And my mind's automatically taken back to when the anatomists had access to bodies that were coming to the anatomy departments from the poorhouses.
Bizarre as it seems to us today, Sue knows that the display of human bodies was once considered perfectly acceptable.
If I'm going to put money on any of this, I could see him late 1800s, even into the early 1900s.
The cold case investigation will focus on three key areas. The history. Where does our boy fit into the strange story of human dissection? The body. They will do stable isotope analysis on his bones and test a sample of resin used to preserve his blood vessels. And facial reconstruction will hopefully give him back his identity. Xanthi's first stop will be a museum collection she's heard may have some specimens that could shed light on the boy's story.
I've no idea really whether he's literally one in his own or whether there are more like him somewhere. So I'm going to go to Edinburgh and see if I can find some evidence as to how unique he might be.
Edinburgh's Surgeons' Hall Museum has housed artefacts belonging to the Royal College of Surgeons in Scotland since 1804. Here, Xanthi's meeting curator Andrew Connell, who wants to show her a bizarre collection donated by the pioneering Scottish anatomist, John Barclay.
Oh, look at that. Oh, wow. Now, that is a young child.
Now, these are from the Barclay collection. John Barclay donated his collection to the college.
Beautifully done. Look at that, all the tiny vessels.
Yeah.
Is it possible to pick him up? Is he very delicate?
If you like to put on a pair of gloves and almost baby-like, if you just support him under his spine at the back.
Yeah.
On his death in 1826, Berkeley left more than 2,500 specimens, some of them children, just like our cold case.
Quite beautiful, isn't he?
Mm. In its own way.
Again, the soft tissue of the face has been left intact, hasn't it? The nose and ears, primarily, in this case. Yeah. He's amazing as well.
Many of these specimens have waxy resin in their blood vessels, just like our boy. There's one exhibit in particular that catches Xanthi's attention.
Oh, wow. He's really, really interesting, very similar to our boy, except he's got less soft tissue on his face, but visually he's very similar. Do you want me to show you our mummified boy?
Sure, so if you wanted to display a particular posture.
There we are, that's our young man.
Let's have a look at the window here. Right. Well, certainly I can see similarities between them.
I think, in terms of when he would have been dissected and naturally mummified, that might be quite a similar match. 1702. Wow.
So, the Dundee case isn't the only surviving specimen of children whose bodies were turned into exhibits. But confirming the date and provenance of the Dundee mummy will involve a lot of hard science. For Sue, the next step is to take detailed measurements of the child's bones. And something doesn't add up.
What I think is happening here is that the top half of the body, the teeth and the collarbone, are telling me this is a child of about 8. The other parts of the body, so the long bones, are telling me that if this was a normal child, then they're going to be much younger, they're going to be 5. I can't believe those. Those are going to be wrong. He's got short little limbs, short little legs and short little arms, simply because there's been some disturbance. There's something going on.
The boy is several centimetres shorter than he should be for his age. To see if she can discover why, Xanthi arranges for him to be scanned at a hospital just up the road.
Charlie, good?
The remains of a mummified child aren't what they're used to. The CT scanner takes a series of x-rays that can be built up into a three-dimensional picture, allowing us to see inside the child's bones. The data will hopefully reveal why the boy is significantly stunted in stature, as well as forming the starting point for Caroline's facial reconstruction.
Oh, look at that.
Huh. There you go.
Wow.
With the scan complete, the images of the boy's leg bones provide Sue with a big clue about events in his early life.
I've got on here now the foot and the lower end of the tibia and the fibula, which is just down at the ankle joint. And that very dense white line is where the bone is growing. But if you look above it, you can see just a ghostly white line that runs across above that. And there's another one above it, and another one above it, and again, and again. These are the Harris lines. And what they tell us is that when that bone was growing, for whatever reason, it went into a stutter. And so that rather than laying down bone and getting bigger, it's gone into a stutter and it leaves behind a line of dense white bone. And this is telling us that this child has gone through episodes of either malnutrition or episodes of disease or something that will affect his growth. And it would be very easy to fit that picture into the workhouses of the 1800s, very, very easily. It's really rather sad, isn't it?
These Harris lines tell us that his bones stopped growing more than once during his childhood. If he was among those living in the workhouses set up in the 1830s, he could easily have lived in squalid conditions, barely surviving on starvation rations. Many who entered the workhouse died, and shocking as it may seem, the bodies often ended up on the anatomist's table. It would be a pitiful end for a small boy. But despite the emotional tug of the case, Sue has to keep her professional distance.
My job as a forensic scientist is to be able to provide objective evidence. If I become involved personally in the case, I start to have my own opinions that somebody should be found guilty, that somebody needs to pay for this, then I am no longer an objective scientist and I should be removed from that arena.
In Edinburgh, historian Owen Dudley Edwards is showing Xanthi a chilling example of a place where corpses of the poor were taken.
Now, we have to be very careful here. Mm-hmm. Very slowly.
This is very dark down here.
Isn't it? Isn't it nice?
Nice.
He's taking Xanthi into what was once a secret tunnel underneath the University of Edinburgh where dead bodies were brought in under the cover of night.
Early 19th centuries.
So this is where they would have been snuck in, basically?
Yes, well, the fact was that there was great hostility among the ordinary people of the city because they believed the doctors were killing the poor to cure the diseases of the rich. So this tunnel existed, and the bodies would be taken in secretly by night on the ground that, as it were, what the crowd didn't know wouldn't trouble them.
Despite public hostility, it seems that the harvesting of bodies was all perfectly above board. In 1832, the government had passed the Anatomy Act, which made it legal for anatomists to claim any unclaimed corpse from the workhouse. But is our boy's story really so simple? Was he donated to an anatomist for dissection under the chilling edicts of the 1832 Anatomy Act? Xanthi is following a new lead to London. The historical picture that's beginning to emerge for the boy is pulling her deeper into his story.
You're dealing with forensic cases. All your training tells you to remain objective and to actively not engage with the person you're looking at and their history and their story. But we're getting to know the little mummified boy a little bit more now. So you find yourself wondering how he would have lived and you're engaging with him on a personal level.
Xanthi is heading to the Hunterian Museum in London, home to Britain's largest collection of human and animal specimens. Simon Chaplin is showing her an extraordinary set of exhibits.
We're surrounded. There's 3,500 specimens here. These are all the work of John Hunter.
And John Hunter was an anatomist, obviously did a lot of dissection.
He was an anatomist, he was a surgeon, yeah. He was a teacher of surgery and anatomy, but he also had a much wider interest in natural history.
John Hunter was an 18th century celebrity who entertained the London elite in his salon in Leicester Square. He was so influential, the Bishop of Durham donated his own rectum to the collection. Some of Hunter's preservations were mummified, others pickled in alcohol, like this rare specimen of an unborn horse. But Simon Chaplin let slip something that could really shake up the investigation.
This is our little boy. Here you go.
The pose in this one is unusual. The raised hand is something that occurs quite often, and it harks back to earlier anatomical textbooks.
Oh, that's interesting. We haven't found anything about the position of the hand yet, and that's one of the things we thought was probably really key about this individual, so that's really probably an earlier specimen.
Well, it reminds me of 17th and early 18th century anatomical textbooks, where anatomical figures were often shown with one hand raised in a kind of classical pose.
Could this be evidence that our boy in fact lived before sourcing bodies for dissection was made legal by the Anatomy Act of 1832? More clues lie in a book by John Hunter's brother, William, from 1784, which points to how widespread the appetite was for human specimens.
And he says here, "I must likewise earnestly recommend it to every student to make and collect as many anatomical preparations as he can." And he goes on to say what preparations, what specimens, a student to have, and he says they should have a preparation of all the blood vessels in their natural situation and two preparations of the trunk of a child. In other words, exactly the kind of preparation that we've been looking
at. Absolutely, yeah.
What Simon reveals is just how sought after these specimens were before the Anatomy Act made the supply of corpses legal. And they could fetch huge sums.
Well, I wanted to show you some of an amazing collection of auction catalogues from the late 18th, early 19th century.
Okay.
And what we have here is the catalogue of anatomical preparations, the property of a surgeon who has declined lecturing in about 1769. And if we look down here, we can see a whole subject in a wainscot case glazed with the arteries completely injected and dissected, and then lot 67, a child with the arteries injected, which sold, according to the annotation here, for £6.
If he'd been sold today, our boy could have fetched £8,500. In life, he might just have been a boy with a bleak future ahead of him, but in death, he could have been a very valuable commodity. Back in Dundee, Caroline begins the painstaking job of reconstructing the child's face. She's reconstructed the faces of the dead from Ramses II to Bach, but the boy represents a new and different challenge.
The first thing that I'll do when I look at facial reconstruction is to go through and make records, take measurements. Specifically with this one, I want to try and establish which is the soft tissue and which is the hard tissue, because that's quite difficult to see on the CT data, especially around the nose where we've got quite a lot of preserved, mummified soft tissues. I think it can be important to try and see this as a living person, because obviously there's been quite a lot of dissection that's been taking place, and there's been quite a lot of conservation of the tissues. And one of the nice things about doing a reconstruction is we should be able to see him as a living individual again. And that will as well give him back some dignity, because obviously this is relatively undignified.
It will take several more weeks before Caroline can fully reconstruct his face. At a team debrief, Xanthi updates the others about her discovery. She thinks that the anatomical books from London and the mummified children in Edinburgh could point to the boy being a much earlier specimen than they first thought.
To find out more about him, went over to the Royal College of Surgeons Museum.
Which one?
Edinburgh. And what we found was they have a number of mummified children over there.
Oh, do they?
Yeah, and this is one of them. And this is a little child. He's probably, I would say, 2 to 3 years old. These are pre the Anatomy Act.
Good heavens.
Everything will depend on forensic tests to pin down an accurate date for our boy. The results of radiocarbon dating a sample of the boy's leg bone proved inconclusive. But could they gain any information from analysing a sample of the waxy resin found in his blood vessels?
So are we saying there's a possibility of getting almost like a signature out of the resin.
Possibly.
That could match you to the person who did it.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
Which is going to be the next thing.
It's a long shot. A small sample of resin will be subjected to mass spectrometry to decipher its chemical makeup. At the Hunterian Museum in London, Simon Chaplin has offered to donate a sample of resin from one of John Hunter's own specimens to see how it compares with the resin in Our Boy.
Okay.
Yeah, this is an ox heart from John Hunter's collection, so from the 18th century. It's been injected. Well, we've found that these extrusions are still quite pliable, and we've taken two specimens here for testing.
Xanthi also needs to pinpoint the ingredients used in the various recipes for resin developed by anatomists. Simon provides the first piece of the jigsaw in a 220-year-old book.
Here we have, is Thomas Pohl's Anatomical Instructor, published in 1790. And then here, what we have is the recipe for a coarse injection, to make a red coarse injection, the kind you would need for injecting the blood vessels.
Exactly, using our mummified child, okay?
Yellow beeswax, 16 ounces. White resin, 8 ounces. Turpentine varnish, 6 ounces. Vermilion, 3 ounces. And these were very expensive artist pigments that they were using.
Oh, I see. Oh, OK, so these would have been readily available to most people. If expensive ingredients, they still would have been available to the students and the doctors.
They would have gone along to a colour shop, the kind of place that sold artist supplies, and they would have bought them there.
Oh, I see. Oh, fantastic.
More research leads to 15 different recipes for resin. The 15 recipes share 13 common ingredients. And she's found an artist supply shop which still stocks the ingredients used by anatomists 2 centuries ago. She's meeting colour man Nicholas Wold.
I'm not sure how you'd say that. Isinglass?
Isinglass.
Isinglass.
Yes, fish glue.
Fish glue?
Fish glue.
Okay.
It comes from the bladder of sturgeon.
Okay. Also, yellow beeswax. Oh, wow. Actual little pellets. Oh, it's definitely beeswax, isn't it? So that's our vermilion.
That's a wonderful colour. It's a poisonous pigment.
What does carmine look like? Wow.
Which again is an absolutely stunning colour.
Really vibrant, isn't it? Paraffin wax, Japan wax, all of these things.
Would definitely have been available.
Gamboy? Is it gamboy?
Gamboge.
Gamboge. Oh, wow. Look at that. Oh.
Gamdamar, which is used for making varnish.
Okay.
That one.
Thank you very much.
Armed with all the ingredients, Xanthi can now organise the chemical analysis of Our Boy's resin. The results might just be able to pinpoint when and where he was originally preserved. In Dundee, our child's face is beginning to come back to life.
Well, the first thing we needed to do, obviously, was to add the missing bit of the cranium. And what we've done there is we've taken in a template of a similar aged and ethnicity skull that we already have in our database, and have morphed that to fit this skull, to fit with the contours of this skull. What I've also done is to copy the missing area of the supraorbital bone on the right-hand side and flipping it and putting it above the right orbit. Also, just because it looks a little strange, I filled the hole that's on the frontal bone on the forehead there, which was a mounting hole.
With the skull complete, Caroline can start adding some of the facial features.
Now, with the eyeballs, we can import spheres of approximately the right size, which is about 22 millimetres in diameter for someone of this age. In order to recreate the nose, I've taken measurements of the width of the nose and some measurements of the nasal aperture. So what I've then been able to do is to import a nose model and alter it to fit this particular skull. And we can also see in profile that we use those two tangents to tell us the most projecting point on the nose. We can see by the angle of them that this individual would have a concave nasal root, which means a curve, an upward curve to the nose, which is also very common in individuals of this age. Most children have little upturned noses. I think you can start to see what he's going to look like. So as soon as we start to see some of his facial features, then we can look at him as a boy rather than a specimen.
Caroline now needs the results of Wolfram's stable isotope tests, which could confirm the theory that the child was malnourished.
It doesn't give us any information about facial features. It won't make any difference to the shape of the face, but what it will do is enable us to choose which tissue depth data to use, whether to use emaciated, normal, or overweight. And I'm waiting to find out that.
The analysis involves sampling a small section of the boy's leg bone. Wolfram is particularly interested in the relative values of isotopes of nitrogen and carbon found in the collagen part of the bone. Called stable isotope testing, this process can reveal crucial information about a person's background.
Largely, it can say, where does someone come from? It can then tell us perhaps something about their diet, what sort of diet they had, were they herbivores, were they carnivores, was it a mixture of that? And when you know the diet, then that gives you some indication of a social status as well. So really those are the three things: the geography, where the person comes from, a bit about the diet, and then we can infer from that maybe a bit of the social status.
While Wolfram hunts for answers about the boy's diet, Xanthi continues her mission. Now armed with a third sample of resin from the Edinburgh mummies prepared by John Barclay, she's come to Northumbria University, where all three samples of resin will be tested.
Hi.
Brian.
Pleased to meet you at last.
I was hoping you can tell me a little bit about the waxy resin that we took out from the mummified child through his arterial system.
The 13 ingredients she picked up in the artist's supply shop will provide the baseline samples for the mass spectrometer. Meanwhile, in Dundee, Sue and her student Scott used some of the ingredients to actually recreate the waxy resin from an 18th century recipe. They're cooking up a mixture of beeswax, pine resin, and turpentine. It may be the first time this has been done in a couple of centuries.
Perhaps if we do it very gently.
Gently.
Yeah. So that it's a slow and gradual process. And then at the very last minute, what we're going to do is put the vermilion in. Ooh, look. Oh, look. It does actually look very like blood. You can see why they've used that, can't you?
Thomas Pohl's book of 1790 also advises on the best sort of body to use.
And it says, for this purpose, which is injecting, adult subjects are seldom used. Oh, how interesting. On the account of the difficulty in completely filling the vessels with injection. So the suggestion there is that to do this article, it's normally done on children.
Sue isn't content with just making up a recipe. She wants to inject it into a blood vessel and see how it works. In this case, it's a pig's aorta from a local butcher's.
If we try and suck it up. Okay. It is a bit. If you can leave that, if you can hold up the aorta, let's see if we can inject it in. Now watch, because it might be quite hot. Let's try. Oh, we can get a flow going.
Yeah, you can feel that hardening quite
can
a bit
you?
Towards the bottom.
Excellent.
Yeah.
You're not burning your fingers, that, is it?
No.
In terms of the injection, that's not going to take much more because it's right at the top there.
Yeah, try to push some more down.
And then it says, yep, it says put it in cold water then.
Okay.
Which is what's supposed to solidify.
I don't think it'll need much help, to be honest.
No. It's quite hard. Yeah, it's quite hard. If you take a plug of it out, for example, look. That's the sort of thing that we were finding inside his blood vessels. It does work.
The last of the forensic tests are now in, so Sue assembles the team. Wolfram has drawn a blank in terms of pinpointing where the boy comes from, but has found something exciting from the nitrogen values in the bone sample.
Cut a long story short, all the nitrogen values point at somebody who had definitely not a protein-deficient diet. Whether the protein came from lots of cheese and whatever, cream cheese or lots of milk, I don't know. Or whether it came from meat or fish or poultry, but it was definitely not meat-deficient.
So this is not a pauper's diet, is it?
Unless the diet in almshouses and pauper's houses was much better than we give them credit for.
Such a protein-rich diet means our child is unlikely to have lived and died in a workhouse. And it would follow unlikely to have been the victim of the 1832 Anatomy Act. The stunted growth that Sue discovered in his bones could have been a result of disease. No one was immune to the epidemics like whooping cough and measles that raged through the population. The news that our boy was well nourished means Caroline can press on with recreating his face.
From my point of view, in terms of the amount of tissue depth we can use for the facial reconstruction, then the best thing for me to do is to use the average. There's no point in using emaciated.
No.
It's now time for Xanthi to drop her own bombshell. She's got the data back from the tests on the resin in the boy's blood vessels.
We sourced a sample of the Barclay collection and the Hunter collection so that
they
actually could
they
compare
gave you
them.
A sample of
yes.
It. Good grief.
Yes.
Mm. Well done.
So we had more than just the recipe to go on because there would have been some variation as people kind of tweaked it, just like any recipe.
Absolutely. So the Hunter material's all in London?
London.
The Barclay material?
Edinburgh. Okay. Yes. Right. So out of the two that they were compared to, it was Hunter that was the closest.
Good grief.
But it was close enough that it could have been a slight variation on Hunter's own recipe. So, I mean, long shot, but it could have been on Hunter himself that did the actual dissection.
So when you go to the Hunterian Museum,
yeah.
Is there something else that matches this?
Comparable, no.
So that what you could be looking at, for argument's sake, if we were absolutely going to take this to the limit,
is the first and only
mm-hmm. example belonging to the Hunterian collection.
Mm. Yeah,
of this
surviving.
Kind of a presentation.
Yeah, possibly.
Outrageous.
Yes.
That makes it very, very important.
Yeah.
So our boy could be one of the first examples of this kind of specimen. And the result that his resin is similar to one of John Hunter's recipes would place our boy in a time well before the 1832 Anatomy Act made obtaining bodies legal.
We're looking at late 18th century, early 19th century, in London,
yeah.
An anatomical specimen,
yeah.
A child that's not particularly undernourished, we're not looking at a poorhouse child.
Nope.
What's happening in London on the anatomical scene at that time?
Before the Anatomy Act.
Before the Anatomy Act.
There was no legal way of obtaining children.
Was it illegal?
Well,
that's the question. You need to speak to somebody who has a good understanding of the anatomical society within London of that time, a good historian.
If our boy was illegally sourced to be experimented on, this is a major turning point.
What's happening in this case is that we've thought this is going to be a post-1832. No, it's not. It's a pre-1832. Completely different set of evidence, completely different path that we want to go down. So you can't predict when something is going to change, and this case has given us quite a number of twists and turns that we just simply couldn't have anticipated.
Does a boy, well-nourished and from London, point to an even darker side of the history of anatomy? Is he a victim of a period when the demand for dead bodies far outstripped the legal supply? When the grave robber was society's bogeyman. Xanthi's about to find out. She's back in London at the Royal College of Surgeons, where she's discovered that they have first-hand evidence that bodies like our boys were stolen. She's meeting archivist Louise King.
Okay, so this is a diary of a resurrectionist from 1811 to 1812. It just covers a few months.
And resurrectionist would have been?
A grave robber, essentially.
Okay. February 2nd.
Went to lookout, met at 5 in the evening, went to the green, got 7 large and 3 small and 3 fetus.
Same night, went to
Wisegate?
Something like that, Wygate, yeah. 4 large and 2 small. Took them to Bartholomew's. So he's going and basically digging up graves, taking 7 large, so 7 adults, I guess, or 7 large children.
No, I think large he tends to use for adults, yeah.
3 children and 3 fetuses.
Yeah.
So he's looking probably for newly buried, newly covered graves.
Yeah, I mean, as I understand it, they had lookouts who would let them know that there'd been burials.
A new burial.
Yeah.
And what was potentially being buried.
Yeah.
So it's almost like a shopping list.
Yeah.
And then taking them to hospitals for the dissection.
That's right, yes.
Wow. And this is the only book of its kind like this?
As far as we know, yes, it is.
Oh, how odd, isn't it? Just saying, like, 7 large and 3 small.
Yeah.
Oh.
It's a fantastic piece of evidence. But this diary is just one man's account. To find out more, Xanthi must immerse herself in the world of the resurrectionist. Will she be able to place our boy in this dark and largely unexplored chapter of British history? In Dundee, armed with the information that the boy had a healthy diet, Caroline is beginning the process of adding flesh to the bone.
I've placed these pegs on that represent the tissue depths. Now, because we found out that this individual wasn't emaciated, didn't have a starvation diet, we've used contemporary 7-8-year-old measurements from a British population. And that really helps us, after we've done the muscle structure, to put the correct amount of tissue over and above the muscles. So the next thing is to import each of the facial muscles and distort it and deform it to fit this particular skull.
Caroline uses haptic or tactile technology that allows her to mimic the experience of building a face from clay. A mechanical arm gives her the sensation of feeling the surface of the head she's reconstructing.
When you touch something on the computer screen, it gives you this what's called haptic feedback. So in other words, you can feel what you're touching on the screen. It enables you to do things with speed, but also look back at what's underneath as well, which is something you can't do with real clay. Once you put a muscle in place, you can't then have a look at the bone underneath again. So this system allows you to constantly check what you've done. So it's kind of exciting working with new technology like this.
Having placed all the muscles, she can now add the tissue. Everything she's done so far is based on the scientific information the team has gathered.
I'd say that the areas where there's most artistic interpretation will be the final additions related to age and texture and colour and hair and all those details that we don't know from the skull.
The facial reconstruction is almost complete. Caroline is on the verge of showing us the face of our boy. In London, Xanthi's digging deeper into the sordid history of the grave robbers. She's come to the very heart of the city to meet author Sarah Wise, who spent 5 years researching the world of the Resurrectionist.
What I'm hoping that Sarah might be able to give me some insight into is how common this was. I mean, if she's got any information which could help us, that's what I'm hoping for, and just lead us down that path towards learning more about his identity, really.
Sarah wants to show Xanthi a London street that runs from the Old Bailey to Smithfield Market. This was the centre for a lucrative trade in fresh corpses driven by demand from nearby medical schools. Every student going through the schools needed at least one body to practice on, so the demand was high. Some of the corpses were mummified for display.
So why have we come here specifically?
This whole stretch really was the centre of the resurrection trade north of the river in London in the early 19th century.
I'm just going to take you up here and show you St Sepulchre's Church. And in 1791, they were so worried about the amount of bodies that were going missing from the graveyard that used to be over the back, that they did what many people, even in small villages, they'd club together and by themselves construct a watch house. So this watch house looked out over onto the graveyard of St Sepulchre, which was at the back.
So specifically to stop the resurrectionists coming in and stealing bodies.
That's right. But unfortunately, a watch house was really only as useful as the man who was running it. And one of the other reasons that body snatching was able to flourish for so long was that a lot of the sextons, the watchmen, were corrupt and for significant payments would, well, not just turn a blind eye, but would open the gates and help.
That's really grim, isn't it?
It's really vile. It's absolutely horrible.
Across the road is the reason why this graveyard was particularly at risk.
So over on the right, we've got St Bartholomew's Hospital, which was one of the largest teaching hospitals in London, and very much in need of as many bodies that the body snatchers could supply them with. So much so that they would the porters would leave hampers, large hampers, outside or within their courtyard for the snatchers to run over, pick up the hamper in order to bring their corpses from here over to there. Because this was the site of the Fortune of War pub, which was the major meeting place and safe house for body snatchers north of the river.
All that remains now is a chilling inscription.
The landlord used to show the room where, on benches round the walls, the bodies were placed, labelled with the snatchers' names, wait until the surgeons at St Bartholomew's could run around and appraise them.
Oh, wow.
This was not exactly, you know, underground then, was it? This was...
It was very out in the open.
So this was a good, lucrative trade.
Very much so.
But was our boy simply stolen from a graveyard? Or was his fate even darker? In a former resurrectionist pub next to Smithfield Market, Sarah reveals just how far some body snatchers were willing to go.
I'd like to show you a document. It's a confession taken the day before his execution from a very prolific body snatcher called John Bishop.
Oh.
The document explains how Bishop and his accomplice lured a 14-year-old boy from a Smithfield pub back to his house.
We lighted a candle and gave the boy some bread and cheese, and after he'd eaten, we gave him a cup full of rum with about half a small phial of laudanum in it. Is that...
That's a tincture of opium.
Yeah. Oh, OK. Was it illegal then?
Laudanum wasn't at all illegal, and in fact, many people in the 19th century used it quite openly and respectably as a sort of tonic or pick-me-up or, you know, some sort of relaxant.
The boy quickly passed out.
We took him directly, asleep and insensible, into the garden, tied a cord to his feet to enable us to pull him up by, and then I took him in my arms and let him slide from them headlong into the well of, in the garden, whilst Williams held the cord to prevent the body going altogether too low into the well. He was nearly wholly in the water of the well, his feet just above the surface. Williams fastened the other end of the cord around the paling to prevent the body getting beyond our reach. The boy struggled a little with his arms and legs in the water, and the water bubbled for a minute.
Oh, this so is just really seems... horrible.
Yes. They tricked this little boy. They got him drunk, partially drunk. They drugged him. They drowned him.
Yes. And consequently, they had an extremely fresh body to start touting around to the surgeons the next morning, which is exactly what they did. And it's exactly what led to their arrest. Unfortunately, it was not the first time they'd behaved in that way. James May, who was his co-defendant at the Old Bailey, he shouted across the bishop, "You're a bloody murdering bastard, and you should have been topped, i.e. hanged, years ago," which indicates strongly that May believed that Bishop had been murdering for years. And the other strange thing, Xanathi, is that the body was in fact noted, and the word that was used was stout. Oh. This boy was not sort of emaciated, he hadn't gone hungry.
Oh, that is interesting. Wow.
Records prove that Bishop snatched up to 1,000 bodies, and he and his gang may have murdered many more than the 3 victims he confessed to in and around Smithfield Market. Panic unleashed by the Bishop case of 1831 highlighted the disappearance of thousands of children, many of them as young as our boy.
I had no idea that the area surrounding Smithfield Market where all of the meat trades take part. This is the centre of the human meat trade. Children were being sourced here, literally for murder, to furnish the anatomists. And it's a shocking and horrifying end for these lives.
Whatever the fate of our 8-year-old child, once handed over to the anatomists, he quickly became faceless and anonymous. But the team is about to give him back his identity. The team's forensic evidence and historical research have revealed that our mummy is an 8-year-old boy who they believe died in London before the Anatomy Act of 1832, which made acquiring dead bodies legal. He was well nourished, but he had lived through periods of ill health. He was either a freshly buried corpse dug up by grave robbers, or he was murdered, like the boy in the Bishop confession.
He picked up this boy, took him home and killed him.
Yeah. Wait till he got a bit sleepy.
Yeah.
Chuck him in the well.
I just think it's getting more tragic as we go along this tale. It started out as an anatomical specimen and then we kind of realised it was, you know...
illegally obtained.
It was a boy and that it was may have been illegally obtained and now it's looking more likely it's a murder and...
opposite.
All for the sake of an anatomical specimen.
But that's anatomy's history.
I know, it's just it? This particular yeah. case, I yeah. didn't expect it to ever, head in that direction.
But were you ever going to have a happy outcome with a dissected seven-year-old? Anatomy has a very, very murky past. And we know it's got a murky past. And ultimately, I think he's a representation of that murky past.
The time has come for Caroline to reveal the final piece of the jigsaw.
So we've got the face, the facial reconstruction, and we've taken that and added some textures. He's been given quite, not neutral, but common hair colour and eye colour, and references from that period of time in terms of hairstyle have been used.
Okay, so this is just
texture,
a still.
Very nice looking boy.
That's good. I like that.
But the reveal and the end of the investigation presents the team with a dilemma.
We've got to decide, I suppose, what we do with them now.
Yep.
And I think there are three choices that I can see. It remains in the department.
We've no. never been
under
with
circumstances
that.
Which I don't think are appropriate.
No. Okay, so that's
we ask the Hunterian Museum or whichever whether they would be prepared to house the specimen appropriately, but with a full story as to how this has unfolded. Or we decide he goes back into the ground.
Maybe we have an opportunity here to educate people about that.
Do you want him to
side.
Become an educational specimen?
Oh, now you make me sound really hard.
I don't like display cabinets. I never really have, I must admit. So if we have any doubt...
We bury him.
Then you bury him. Mm. Then I think our decision is that he should be buried.
Would you have felt the same before you saw his face?
Yes. Wouldn't have made any difference. Because I do feel very, very strongly about human remains, and I do feel very strongly about their display. And as an anatomist, I feel a responsibility.
After more than 170 years, the History Cold Case team has given our 8-year-old boy back his face and his dignity. For Sue, the case of the mummified child can now be closed.
I think the fact that in this case we've gone from something about which we knew absolutely nothing to a point now that we can almost pinpoint him down in time, that we know which anatomy house he's most closely related to, and we can start to place him within the context of that time. That's an incredible achievement in a very short space of time. And I must admit, it's not something that for a moment, if I'd been honest at the outset, I didn't think we were going to get very far. We have gone much, much further than I could ever have anticipated. This is just about as good as it gets.
Next time, we head back to medieval Scotland as the team try to piece together the identity of an extraordinary skeleton unearthed at Stirling Castle.
He certainly had a nasty crack to the top of his head.
It could be our man.
Yes.
Ooh, it could okay. Be
Britain's finest unit for forensic investigation is embarking on a new and groundbreaking mission. They're experts in human identification using the full arsenal of modern technology. But now, for the first time, they're applying these skills to bodies from the long, distant past.
It's very exciting for us to be able to take the skills that we use on a daily basis and apply them to look at historical skeletons to see just how far we can go.
Forensic anthropology, facial reconstruction, and painstaking research will open new windows on history as dramatic personal stories emerge from long forgotten bones.
Historical research is allowing me to investigate people's experiences at different times throughout history.
He certainly had a nasty crack to the top of his head.
That must have been so painful.
So we've got the face, the facial reconstruction, and we've added some textures.
Yeah. Fantastic. Yeah. That is just superb.
This time, the cold case team is heading back into a dark corner of the 19th century, when corpses were turned into trophies and children were sold by the inch. Oh,
this just seems really horrible.
Yes.
Their subject, the strange mummified skeleton of a child. Its brain has been removed, its blood vessels filled with wax. A child who deserved a better fate. Can they give him back a home, a face, a name? This is History Cold Case. The Centre for Anatomy and Human Identification, part of the University of Dundee. The forensic unit is about to take on a challenging new case surrounding an extraordinary set of human remains, the mummified skeleton of a child. Its identity is a mystery. For Professor Sue Black, leader of the cold case team, this is much more than just a set of bones. It's the start of the story. With her colleague, Dr. Xanthi Mallet, she begins with the first observation of the body.
Boy to look at.
Isn't he lovely?
He's beautiful.
The skeleton was donated by a colleague. Sue thinks it's over 100 years old and is some sort of anatomical specimen, dissected for the purposes of display.
A very good friend said, you know, I brought you a present. And I thought, well, you know, chocolates would have been nice.
Whiskey
would have
been nicer.
Would have been fine, but, you know, this is what we get as a present. Probably a little boy, somewhere around about 8. And I have to say, I've never seen anything like it before. No. I really haven't. No.
Transform the body, the top half of the skull has been sawn off and the chest prized open to remove internal organs. But some of the blood vessels are still preserved, carefully filled with a waxy resin.
Is he naturally mummified?
No, I don't think so. Because what you can, if you can see, these red bits that are sort of poking out here, these are resin. And this is a process that's called perfusion, where you place a substance into a vessel to make it stand out so that you can see it.
Until well into the 19th century, anatomists and surgeons commonly dissected and preserved human bodies as part of their training.
Okay, so that's
a specimen like this one could have been used as a teaching aid.
But look at the cross, look at the flow and the line of that.
Yeah.
They're very artistic. And when you hold them, lift them up, it's really quite...
It's pretty solid, isn't it?
Well, it is, but it's really rather impressive that that's how he would be hanging, looking like that.
Sue never forgets that her subjects were once living people.
There is a sadness in the case. There is no doubting there is a sadness. This was somebody's son. This little boy did have a mum. Whether he had a dad at home or not, we don't know, but he certainly would have had some family. But did anybody care enough when this happened to him? We don't know. I need to know who he is. I need to find that out. He needs that respect.
The initial examination confirms only the basic facts. He's a boy, probably around 8 years old. But can the cold case team discover anything about who he was, where he came from, when he lived, and of course, how he came to be hanging on a wall as some macabre display? Sue calls the first briefing.
This is what's been rather affectionately become known as the problem child of our department. So it's a little boy between 6 and 8.
Dr. Wolfram Meyer-Augenstein will hunt for chemical signatures in the boy's bones, which could reveal information about where he lived and what kind of life he had. Dr. Caroline Wilkinson will perform the important task of giving the boy back his face.
Is there enough face there for you to... Yeah. Do something okay. with.
Yeah.
Yeah? What about the fact that there's still some soft tissue on a nose and his ears are still there?
Yeah.
Oh, are they?
You can see one of the... Yeah. They're really you can really see one of the blood vessels.
Sue thinks the red wax found in the boy's blood vessels could provide crucial physical clues in the case.
This resin, this wax... When you mould it, so if you take a little bit out, you put it in your fingers and you smell it. My father was a cabinet maker, so constant smell of linseed oil and waxes and those sorts of things. It smells like the inside of my father's furniture van. So it must be oils or wax of some kind.
Xanthi's task is to get out on the road, to gather evidence from historical records and experts in other fields, starting with the history of anatomy.
But where do you get... a 7-year-old, 8-year-old boy from? At what point in history have we got access to children that we could do that to? And my mind's automatically taken back to when the anatomists had access to bodies that were coming to the anatomy departments from the poorhouses.
Bizarre as it seems to us today, Sue knows that the display of human bodies was once considered perfectly acceptable.
If I'm going to put money on any of this, I could see him late 1800s, even into the early 1900s.
The cold case investigation will focus on three key areas. The history. Where does our boy fit into the strange story of human dissection? The body. They will do stable isotope analysis on his bones and test a sample of resin used to preserve his blood vessels. And facial reconstruction will hopefully give him back his identity. Xanthi's first stop will be a museum collection she's heard may have some specimens that could shed light on the boy's story.
I've no idea really whether he's literally one in his own or whether there are more like him somewhere. So I'm going to go to Edinburgh and see if I can find some evidence as to how unique he might be.
Edinburgh's Surgeons Hall Museum has housed artefacts belonging to the Royal College of Surgeons in Scotland since 1804. Here, Xanthi's meeting curator Andrew Connell, who wants to show her a bizarre collection donated by the pioneering Scottish anatomist, John Barclay.
Oh, look at that. Oh, wow. Now that is a young child.
Now these are from the Barclay collection. John Barclay donated his collection to the college.
Beautifully done. Look at that, all the tiny vessels.
Yeah.
Is it possible to pick him up? Is he very delicate?
If you like to put on a pair of gloves and almost, almost baby-like if you just support him under his spine at the back.
Yeah.
On his death in 1826, Berkeley left more than 2,500 specimens, some of them children, just like our cold case.
It's quite beautiful, isn't it?
In its own way.
Again, the soft tissue of the face has been left intact, hasn't it? The nose and ears, primarily, in this case. Yeah. He's amazing as well.
Many of these specimens have waxy resin in their blood vessels, just like our boy. There's one exhibit in particular that catches Xanthi's attention.
Oh, wow. He's really, really interesting, very similar to our boy, except he's got less soft tissue on his face, but visually he's very similar. Do you want me to show you our mummified boy?
Sure, if you wanted to display a particular posture.
There we are, that's our young man.
Let's have a look at the window here. Right. Well, certainly I can see similarities between them.
I think in terms of when he would have been dissected and naturally mummified, that might be quite a similar match. 1702. Wow.
So, the Dundee case isn't the only surviving specimen of children whose bodies were turned into exhibits. But confirming the date and provenance of the Dundee mummy will involve a lot of hard science. For Sue, the next step is to take detailed measurements of the child's bones. And something doesn't add up.
What I think is happening here is that the top half of the body, the teeth and the collarbone, are telling me this is a child of about 8. The other parts of the body, so the long bones, are telling me that if this was a normal child, then they're going to be much younger, they're going to be 5. I can't believe those. Those are going to be wrong. He's got short little limbs, short little legs and short little arms, simply because there's been some disturbance. There's something going on.
The boy is several centimetres shorter than he should be for his age. To see if she can discover why, Xanthi arranges for him to be scanned at a hospital just up the road.
Charlie, good?
The remains of a mummified child aren't what they're used to. The CT scanner takes a series of x-rays that can be built up into a three-dimensional picture, allowing us to see inside the child's bones. The data will hopefully reveal why the boy is significantly stunted in stature, as well as forming the starting point for Caroline's facial reconstruction.
Oh, look at that.
Huh. There you go.
Wow.
With the scan complete, the images of the boy's leg bones provide Sue with a big clue about events in his early life.
I've got on here now the foot and the lower end of the tibia and the fibula, which is just down at the ankle joint. And that very dense white line is where the bone is growing. But if you look above it, you can see just a ghostly white line that runs across above that. And there's another one above it, and another one above it, and again, and again. These are the Harris lines. And what they tell us is that when that bone was growing, for whatever reason, it went into a stutter. And so that rather than laying down bone and getting bigger, it's gone into a stutter and it leaves behind a line of dense white bone. And this is telling us that this child has gone through episodes of either malnutrition or episodes of disease or something that will affect his growth. And it would be very easy to fit that picture into the workhouses of the 1800s, very, very easily. It's really rather sad, isn't it?
These Harris lines tell us that his bones stopped growing more than once during his childhood. If he was among those living in the workhouses set up in the 1830s, he could easily have lived in squalid conditions, barely surviving on starvation rations. Many who entered the workhouse died, and shocking as it may seem, the bodies often ended up on the anatomist's table. It would be a pitiful end for a small boy. But despite the emotional tug of the case, Sue has to keep her professional distance.
My job as a forensic scientist is to be able to provide objective evidence. If I become involved personally in the case, I start to have my own opinions that somebody should be found guilty, that somebody needs to pay for this, then I am no longer an objective scientist and I should be removed from that arena.
In Edinburgh, historian Owen Dudley Edwards is showing Xanthi a chilling example of a place where corpses of the poor were taken.
Now, we have to be very careful here. Mm-hmm. Very slowly.
This is very dark down here.
Isn't it? Isn't it nice?
Nice?
He's taking Xanthi into what was once a secret tunnel underneath the University of Edinburgh where dead bodies were brought in under the cover of night.
So this is where they would have been snuck in, basically.
Yes, well, the fact was that there was great hostility among the ordinary people of the city because they believed the doctors were killing the poor to cure the diseases of the rich. So this tunnel existed, and the bodies would be taken in secretly by night on the ground that, as it were, what the crowd didn't know wouldn't trouble them.
Despite public hostility, it seems that the harvesting of bodies was all perfectly above board. In 1832, the government had passed the Anatomy Act, which made it legal for anatomists to claim any unclaimed corpse from the workhouse. But is our boy's story really so simple? Was he donated to an anatomist for dissection under the chilling edicts of the 1832 Anatomy Act? Xanthi is following a new lead to London. The historical picture that's beginning to emerge for the boy is pulling her deeper into his story.
You're dealing with forensic cases. All your training tells you to remain objective and to actively not engage with the person you're looking at and their history and their story. But we're getting to know the little mummified boy a little bit more now. So you find yourself wondering how he would have lived and you're engaging with him on a personal level.
Xanthi is heading to the Hunterian Museum in London, home to Britain's largest collection of human and animal specimens. Simon Chaplin is showing her an extraordinary set of exhibits.
We're surrounded. There's 3,500 specimens here. These are all the work of John Hunter.
And John Hunter was an anatomist, obviously did a lot of dissection.
He was an anatomist, he was a surgeon, he was a teacher of surgery and anatomy, but he also had a much wider interest in natural history.
John Hunter was an 18th century celebrity who entertained the London elite in his salon in Leicester Square. He was so influential, the Bishop of Durham donated his own rectum to the collection. Some of Hunter's preservations were mummified, others pickled in alcohol, like this rare specimen of an unborn horse. But Simon Chaplin let slip something that could really shake up the investigation.
This is our little boy. Here you go.
The pose in this one is unusual. The raised hand is something that occurs quite often, and it harks back to earlier anatomical textbooks.
Oh, that's interesting. We haven't found anything about the position of the hand yet, and that's one of the things we thought was probably really key about this individual, so that's really probably an earlier specimen.
Well, it reminds me of 17th and early 18th century anatomical textbooks, where anatomical figures were often shown with one hand raised in a kind of classical pose.
Could this be evidence that our boy in fact lived before sourcing bodies for dissection was made legal by the Anatomy Act of 1832? More clues lie in a book by John Hunter's brother, William, from 1784, which points to how widespread the appetite was for human specimens.
And he says here, I must likewise earnestly recommend it to every student to make and collect as many anatomical preparations as he can. And he goes on to say what preparations, what specimens, a student to have, and he says they should have a preparation of all of the blood vessels in their natural situation and two preparations of the trunk of a child. In other words, exactly the kind of preparation that we've been
absolutely
looking at.
What Simon reveals is just how sought after these specimens were before the Anatomy Act made the supply of corpses legal. And they could fetch huge sums.
Well, I wanted to show you some of an amazing collection of auction catalogues from the late 18th, early 19th century.
Okay.
And what we have here is the catalogue of anatomical preparations, the property of a surgeon who has declined lecturing in about 1769. And if we look down here, we can see a whole subject in a wainscot case glazed with the arteries completely injected and dissected, and then lot 67, a child with the arteries injected, which sold, according to the annotation here, for £6.
If he'd been sold today, our boy could have fetched £8,500. In life, he might just have been a boy with a bleak future ahead of him, but in death, he could have been a very valuable commodity. Back in Dundee, Caroline begins the painstaking job of reconstructing the child's face. She's reconstructed the faces of the dead from Ramses II to Bach. But the boy represents a new and different challenge.
The first thing that I'll do when I look at facial reconstruction is to go through and make records, take measurements. Specifically with this one, I want to try and establish which is the soft tissue and which is the hard tissue, because that's quite difficult to see on the CT data, especially around the nose where we've got quite a lot of preserved, mummified soft tissues. I think it can be important to try and see this as a living person, because obviously there's been quite a lot of dissection that's been taking place, and there's been quite a lot of conservation of the tissues. And one of the nice things about doing a reconstruction is we should be able to see him as a living individual again. And that will as well give him back some dignity, because obviously this is relatively undignified.
It will take several more weeks before Caroline can fully reconstruct his face. At a team debrief, Xanthi updates the others about her discovery. She thinks that the anatomical books from London and the mummified children in Edinburgh could point to the boy being a much earlier specimen than they first thought.
To find out more about him, went over to the Royal College of Surgeons Museum.
Which one?
Edinburgh. And what we found was they have a number of mummified children over there.
Oh, do they?
Yeah, and this is one of them. And this is a little child. He's probably, I would say, 2 to 3 years old. These are pre the Anatomy Act.
Good heavens.
Everything will depend on forensic tests to pin down an accurate date for our boy. The results of radiocarbon dating a sample of the boy's leg bone proved inconclusive. But could they gain any information from analysing a sample of the waxy resin found in his blood vessels?
So are we saying there's a possibility of getting almost like a signature out of the resin.
Possibly.
That could match you to the person who did it.
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
Which is going to be the next stain.
It's a long shot. A small sample of resin will be subjected to mass spectrometry to decipher its chemical makeup. At the Hunterian Museum in London, Simon Chaplin has offered to donate a sample of resin from one of John Hunter's own specimens to see how it compares with the resin in Our Boy.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, this is an ox heart from John Hunter's collection, so from the 18th century. It's been injected. Well, we've found that these extrusions are still quite pliable, and we've taken two specimens here for testing.
Xanthi also needs to pinpoint the ingredients used in the various recipes for resin developed by anatomists. Simon provides the first piece of the jigsaw in a 220-year-old book.
Well, here we have, is Thomas Pohl's Anatomical Instructor, published in 1790. And then here, what we have is the recipe for a coarse injection to make a red coarse injection, the kind
exactly,
you would need for injecting
exactly
the blood vessels.
Exactly, using our mummified child, okay?
Yellow beeswax, 16 ounces. White resin, 8 ounces. Turpentine varnish, 6 ounces. Vermilion, 3 ounces.
Bizarre as it seems to us today, Sue knows that the display of human bodies was once considered perfectly acceptable.
If I'm going to put money on any of this, I could see him late 1800s, even into the early 1900s.
The cold case investigation will focus on three key areas. The history. Where does Our Boy fit into the strange story of human dissection? The body. They will do stable isotope analysis on his bones and test a sample of resin used to preserve his blood vessels. And facial reconstruction will hopefully give him back his identity. Xanthi's first stop will be a museum collection she's heard may have some specimens that could shed light on the boy's story.
I've no idea really whether he's literally one in his own or whether there are more like him somewhere. So I'm going to go to Edinburgh and see if I can find some evidence as to how unique he might be.
Edinburgh's Surgeons' Hall Museum has housed artefacts belonging to the Royal College of Surgeons in Scotland since 1804. Here, Xanthi's meeting curator Andrew Connell, who wants to show her a bizarre collection donated by the pioneering Scottish anatomist John Barclay.
Oh, look at that.
Oh, wow. Now, that is a young child.
Now, these are from the Barclay collection. Okay. John Barclay donated his collection to the college.
Beautifully done. Look at that, all the tiny vessels.
Yeah.
Is it possible to pick him up? Is he very delicate?
If you like to put on a pair of gloves and almost baby-like if you just support him under his spine at the back.
Yeah.
On his death in 1826, Barclay left more than 2,500 specimens, some of them children, just like our cold case.
It's quite beautiful, isn't it?
Mm. In its own way.
Again, the soft tissue of the face has been left intact, hasn't it? The nose and ears, primarily, in this case.
Yeah.
He's amazing as well.
Many of these specimens have waxy resin in their blood vessels, just like Our Boy. There's one exhibit in particular that catches Xanthi's attention.
Oh, wow.
He's really, really interesting, very similar to Our Boy, except he's got less soft tissue on his face, but visually he's very similar. Do you want me to show you our mummified boy?
Sure, if you wanted to display a particular posture.
There we are, that's our young man.
Let's have a look at the window here. Right. Well, certainly I can see similarities between them.
I think in terms of when he would have been dissected and naturally mummified, that might be quite a similar match. 1702. Wow.
So, the Dundee case isn't the only surviving specimen of children whose bodies were turned into exhibits. But confirming the date and provenance of the Dundee mummy will involve a lot of hard science. For Sue, the next step is to take detailed measurements of the child's bones. And something doesn't add up.
What I think is happening here is that the top half of the body, the teeth and the collarbone, are telling me this is a child of about 8. The other parts of the body, so the long bones, are telling me that if this was a normal child, then they're going to be much younger, they're going to be 5. I can't believe those. Those are going to be wrong. He's got short little limbs, short little legs and short little arms, simply because there's been some disturbance. There's something going on.
The boy is several centimetres shorter than he should be for his age. To see if she can discover why, Xanthi arranges for him to be scanned at a hospital just up the road.
Charlie, good?
The remains of a mummified child aren't what they're used to. The CT scanner takes a series of X-rays that can be built up into a three-dimensional picture, allowing us to see inside the child's bones. The data will hopefully reveal why the boy is significantly stunted in stature, as well as forming the starting point for Caroline's facial reconstruction.
Oh, look at that.
Huh. There you go.
Wow.
With the scan complete, the images of the boy's leg bones provide Sue with a big clue about events in his early life.
I've got on here now the foot and the lower end of the tibia and the fibula, which is just down at the ankle joint. And that very dense white line is where the bone is growing. But if you look above it, you can see just a ghostly white line that runs across above that. And there's another one above it, and another one above it, and again, and again. These are the Harris lines. And what they tell us is that when that bone was growing, for whatever reason, it went into a stutter. And so that rather than laying down bone and getting bigger, it's gone into a stutter and it leaves behind a line of dense white bone. And this is telling us that this child has gone through episodes of either malnutrition or episodes of disease or something that will affect his growth. And it would be very easy to fit that picture into the workhouses of the 1800s, very, very easily. It's really rather sad, isn't it?
These Harris lines tell us that his bones stopped growing more than once during his childhood. If he was among those living in the workhouses set up in the 1830s, he could easily have lived in squalid conditions, barely surviving on starvation rations. Many who entered the workhouse died, and shocking as it may seem, the bodies often ended up on the anatomist's table. Be a pitiful end for a small boy. But despite the emotional tug of the case, Sue has to keep her professional distance.
My job as a forensic scientist is to be able to provide objective evidence. If I become involved personally in the case, I start to have my own opinions that somebody should be found guilty, that somebody needs to pay.
Answers about the boy's diet, Xanthi continues her mission. Now armed with a third sample of resin from the Edinburgh mummies prepared by John Barclay, she's come to Northumbria University where all three samples of resin will be tested.
Hi.
Hi.
Pleased to meet you at last.
I was hoping you can tell me a little bit about the waxy resin
that we took out from the mummified child through his arterial system.
The 13 ingredients she picked up in the artist's supply shop will provide the baseline samples for the mass spectrometer. Meanwhile, in Dundee, Sue and her student Scott used some of the ingredients to actually recreate the waxy resin from an 18th century recipe. They're cooking up a mixture of beeswax, pine resin, and turpentine. It may be the first time this has been done in a couple of centuries.
Perhaps if we do it very gently.
Gently.
Yeah. So that it's a slow and gradual process. And then at the very last minute, what we're going to do is put the vermilion in. Ooh, look. Oh, look. It does actually look very like blood. You can see why they've used that, can't you?
Thomas Pohl's book of 1790 also advises on the best sort of body to use.
And it says, for this purpose, which is injecting, adult subjects are seldom used. Oh, how interesting. On the account of the difficulty in completely filling the vessels with injection. So the suggestion there is that to do this article, it's normally done on children.
Sue isn't content with just making up a recipe. She wants to inject it into a blood vessel and see how it works. In this case, it's a pig's aorta from a local butcher's.
If we try and suck it up... Okay. It is a bit. If you can... Leave that. If you can hold up the aorta, let's see if we can inject it in. Now watch, because it might be quite hot. Let's try. Oh, we can get a flow going.
You can feel that hardening quite a bit down towards the bottom.
Excellent. Yeah. Not burning your fingers, that, is it?
No.
In terms of the injection, that's not going to take much more because it's right at the top there.
Yeah, push some more down.
And then it says, yep, it says put it in cold water then.
Okay.
Which is what's supposed to solidify.
I don't think it'll need much help, to be honest.
No. It's quite hard. Yeah, it's quite hard. If you take a plug of it out, for example, look. That's the sort of thing that we were finding inside his blood vessels. It does work.
The last of the forensic tests are now in, so Sue assembles the team. Wolfram has drawn a blank in terms of pinpointing where the boy comes from, but has found something exciting from the nitrogen values in the bone sample.
Cut a long story short, all the nitrogen values point at somebody who had definitely not a protein-deficient diet. Whether the protein came from lots of cheese and whatever, cream cheese or lots of milk, I don't know. Or whether it came from meat or fish or poultry, but it was definitely not meat deficient.
So this is not a pauper's diet, is it?
Unless the diet in almshouses and pauper's houses was much better than we give them credit for.
No.
Such a protein-rich diet means our child is unlikely to have lived and died in a workhouse. And it would follow unlikely to have been the victim of the 1832 Anatomy Act. The stunted growth that Sue discovered in his bones could have been a result of disease. No one was immune to the epidemics like whooping cough and measles that raged through the population. The news that our boy was well nourished means Caroline can press on with recreating his face.
From my point of view, in terms of the amount of tissue depth we can use for the facial reconstruction, then the best thing for me to do is to use the average. There's no point in using emaciated.
No.
It's now time for Xanthi to drop her own bombshell. She's got the data back from the tests on the resin in the boy's blood vessels.
We sourced a sample of the Barclay collection and the Hunter collection so that you actually could compare them.
They gave you a sample of
Yes.
That. Good grief.
Yes.
Mm. Well done.
So we had more than just the recipe to go on because there would have been some variation as people kind of tweaked it, just like any recipe.
Absolutely.
So the Hunter materials all in London?
London.
The Barclay material?
Edinburgh, okay. Yes. Right. So out of the two that they were compared to, it was Hunter that was the closest.
Good grief.
But it was close enough that it could have been a slight variation on Hunter's own recipe. So, I mean, long shot, but it could have been on Hunter himself that did the actual dissection.
So when you go to the Hunterian Museum,
yeah.
Is there something else that matches this?
Comparable, no.
So that what you could be looking at, for argument's sake, if we were absolutely going to take this to the limit,
is the first and only
mm-hmm. example belonging to the Hunterian collection
of
this
surviving.
Kind of a presentation.
Yeah, possibly.
Outrageous.
Yes.
That makes it very, very important.
Yeah.
So our boy could be one of the first examples of this kind of specimen. And the result that his resin is similar to one of John Hunter's recipes would place our boy in a time well before the 1832 Anatomy Act made obtaining bodies legal.
We're looking at late 18th century, early 19th century, in London,
yeah.
An anatomical specimen,
yeah.
A child that's not particularly undernourished, we're not looking at a poorhouse child.
No.
What's happening in London on the anatomical scene at that time?
Before the Anatomy Act.
Before the Anatomy Act.
There was no legal way of obtaining children.
Was it illegal?
Well,
that's the question. You need to speak to somebody who has a good understanding of the anatomical society within London of that time, a good historian.
If our boy was illegally sourced to be experimented on, this is a major turning point.
What's happening in this case is that we've thought this is going to be a post-1832. No, it's not. It's a pre-1832. Completely different set of evidence, completely different path that we want to go down. So you can't predict when something is going to change, and this case has given us quite a number of twists and turns that we just simply couldn't have anticipated.
Does a boy, well-nourished and from London, point to an even...
...for this, then I am no longer an objective scientist and I should be removed from that arena.
In Edinburgh, historian Owen Dudley Edwards is showing Xanthi a chilling example of a place where corpses of the poor were taken.
Now, we have to be very careful here. Mm-hmm. Very slowly.
This is very dark down here.
Isn't it? Isn't it nice?
Nice?
He's taking Xanthi into what was once a secret tunnel underneath the University of Edinburgh where dead bodies were brought in under the cover of night.
Early 19th centuries.
So this is where they would have been snuck in, basically.
Yes, well, the fact was that there was great hostility among the ordinary people of the city because they believed the doctors were killing the poor to cure the diseases of the rich. So this tunnel existed, and the bodies would be taken in secretly by night on the ground that, as it were, what the crowd didn't know wouldn't trouble them.
Despite public hostility, it seems that the harvesting of bodies was all perfectly above board. In 1832, the government had passed the Anatomy Act, which made it legal for anatomists to claim any unclaimed corpse from the workhouse. But is our boy's story really so simple? Was he donated to an anatomist for dissection under the chilling edicts of the 1832 Anatomy Act? Xanthi is following a new lead to London. The historical picture that's beginning to emerge for the boy is pulling her deeper into his story.
You're dealing with forensic cases. All your training tells you to remain objective and to actively not engage with the person you're looking at and their history and their story. But we're getting to know the little mummified boy a little bit more now. So you find yourself wondering how he would have lived, and you're engaging with him on a personal level.
Xanthi is heading to the Hunterian Museum in London, home to Britain's largest collection of human and animal specimens. Simon Chaplin is showing her an extraordinary set of exhibits.
We're surrounded. There's 3,500 specimens here. These are all the work of John Hunter.
And John Hunter was an anatomist, obviously did a lot of dissection.
He was an anatomist, he was a surgeon, he was a teacher of surgery and anatomy, but he also had a much wider interest in natural history.
John Hunter was an 18th century celebrity who entertained the London elite in his salon in Leicester Square. He was so influential, the Bishop of Durham donated his own rectum to the collection. Some of Hunter's preservations were mummified, others pickled in alcohol, like this rare specimen of an unborn horse. But Simon Chaplin let slip something that could really shake up the investigation.
This is our little boy. Here you go.
The pose in this one is unusual. The raised hand is something that occurs quite often, and it harks back to earlier anatomical textbooks.
Oh, that's interesting. We haven't found anything about the position of the hand yet, and that's one of the things we thought was probably really key about this individual, so that's really probably an earlier specimen.
Well, it reminds me of 17th and early 18th century anatomical textbooks, where anatomical figures were often shown with one hand raised in a kind of classical pose.
Could this be evidence that our boy in fact lived before sourcing bodies for dissection was made legal by the Anatomy Act of 1832? More clues lie in a book by John Hunter's brother, William, from 1784, which points to how widespread the appetite was for human specimens.
And he says here, "I must likewise earnestly recommend it to every student to make and collect as many anatomical preparations as he can." And he goes on to say what preparations, what specimens, a student to have. And he says they should have a preparation of all of the blood vessels in their natural situation and two preparations of the trunk of a child. In other words, exactly the kind of preparation that we've been looking
at. Absolutely, yeah.
What Simon reveals is just how sought after these specimens were before the Anatomy Act made the supply of corpses legal. And they could fetch huge sums.
Well, I wanted to show you some of an amazing collection of auction catalogues from the late 18th, early 19th century.
Okay.
And what we have here is the catalogue of anatomical preparations, the property of a surgeon who has declined lecturing in about 1769. And if we look down here, we can see a whole subject in a wainscot case glazed with the arteries completely injected and dissected, and then lot 67, a child with the arteries injected, which sold, according to the annotation here, for £6.
If he'd been sold today, our boy could have fetched £8,500. In life, he might just have been a boy with a bleak future ahead of him, but in death, he could have been a very valuable commodity. Back in Dundee, Caroline begins the painstaking job of reconstructing the child's face. She's reconstructed the faces of the dead from Ramses II to Bach. But the boy represents a new and different challenge.
The first thing that I'll do when I look at facial reconstruction is to go through and make records, take measurements. Specifically with this one, I want to try and establish which is the soft tissue and which is the hard tissue, because that's quite difficult to see on the CT data, especially around the nose where we've got
quite a lot of preserved, mummified soft tissues. I think it can be important to try and see this as a living person, because obviously there's been quite a lot of dissection that's been taking place, and there's been quite a lot of conservation of the tissues. And one of the nice things about doing a reconstruction is we should be able to see him as a living individual again. And that will as well give him back some dignity, because obviously this is relatively undignified.
It will take several more weeks before Caroline can fully reconstruct his face. At a team debrief, Xanthi updates the others about her discovery. She thinks that the anatomical books from London and the mummified children in Edinburgh could point to the boy being a much earlier specimen than they first thought.
To find out more about him, went over to the Royal College of Surgeons Museum.
Which one?
Edinburgh. And what we found was they have a number of mummified children over there.
Oh, do they?
Yeah. And this is one of them. And this is a little child. He's probably, I would say, 2 to 3 years old. These are pre the Anatomy Act.
Good heavens.
Everything will depend on forensic tests to pin down an accurate date for our boy. The results of radiocarbon dating a sample of the boy's leg bone proved inconclusive. But could they gain any information from analysing a sample of the waxy resin found in his blood vessels?
So are we saying there's a possibility of getting almost like a signature out of the resin?
Possibly.
That could match you to the person who did it?
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
Which is going to be the next stage.
It's a long shot. A small sample of resin will be subjected to mass spectrometry to decipher its chemical makeup. At the Hunterian Museum in London, Simon Chaplin has offered to donate a sample of resin from one of John Hunter's own specimens to see how it compares with the resin in our boy.
Okay.
Yeah, this is an ox heart from John Hunter's collection, so from the 18th century. It's been injected. Well, we've found that these extrusions are still quite pliable, and we've taken two specimens here for testing.
Xanthi also needs to pinpoint the ingredients used in the various recipes for resin developed by anatomists. Simon provides the first piece of the jigsaw in a 220-year-old book.
Here we have, is Thomas Pohl's Anatomical Instructor, published in 1790. And then here, what we have is the recipe for a coarse injection, to make a red coarse injection, the kind
exactly,
you would need for injecting
exactly
the blood vessels.
Exactly, using our mummified child, okay?
Yellow beeswax, 16 ounces. White resin, 8 ounces. Turpentine varnish, 6 ounces. Vermilion, 3 ounces. And these were very expensive artist pigments that they were using.
Oh, I see. Oh, OK, so these would have been readily available to most people. If expensive ingredients, they still would have been available to the students and the doctors.
They would have gone along to a colour shop, the kind of place that sold artist supplies, and they would have bought them there.
Oh, I see. Oh, fantastic.
More research leads to 15 different recipes for resin. The 15 recipes share 13 common ingredients. And she's found an artist supply shop which still stocks the ingredients used by anatomists 2 centuries ago. She's meeting colour man Nicholas Wold.
I'm not sure how you'd say that. Isinglass?
Isinglass.
Isinglass.
Yes, fish glue.
Fish glue?
Fish glue.
Okay.
It comes from the bladder of sturgeon.
Okay. Also, yellow beeswax. Oh, wow. Actual little pellets. Oh, it's definitely beeswax, isn't it? So that's our vermilion.
That's a wonderful colour. It's a poisonous pigment.
What does carmine look like? Wow.
Which again is an absolutely stunning colour.
Really vibrant, isn't it? Paraffin wax, Japan wax, all of these things
would definitely have been available.
Gamboy? Is it
Gamboge.
Gamboge.
Oh, wow. Look at that. Oh.
Gamme d'amarre, which is used for making varnish.
Okay.
That one.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much.
Armed with all the ingredients, Xanthi can now organise the chemical analysis of our boy's resin. The results might just be able to pinpoint when and where he was originally preserved. In Dundee, our child's face is beginning to come back to life.
Well, the first thing we needed to do, obviously, was to add the missing bit of the cranium. And what we've done there is we've taken in a template of a similar aged and ethnicity skull that we already have in our database, and have morphed that to fit this skull, to fit with the contours of this skull. What I've also done is to copy the missing area of the supraorbital bone on the right-hand side and flipping it and putting it above the right orbit. Also, just because it looks a little strange, I filled the hole that's on the frontal bone on the forehead there, which was a mounting hole.
With the skull complete, Caroline can start adding some of the facial features.
Now, with the eyeballs, we can import spheres of approximately the right size, which is about 22 millimetres in diameter for someone of this age. In order to recreate the nose, I've taken measurements of the width of the nose and some measurements of the nasal aperture. So what I've then been able to do is to import a nose model and alter it to fit this particular skull. And we can also see in profile that we use those two tangents to tell us the most projecting point on the nose. We can see by the angle of them that this individual would have a concave nasal root, which means a curve, an upward curve to the nose, which is also very common in individuals of this age. Most children have little upturned noses. I think you can start to see what he's going to look like. So as soon as we start to see some of his facial features, then we can look at him as a boy rather than a specimen.
Caroline now needs the results of Wolfram's stable isotope tests, which could confirm the theory that the child was malnourished.
It doesn't give us any information about facial features. It won't make any difference to the shape of the face, but what it will do is enable us to choose which tissue depth data to use, whether to use emaciated, normal, or overweight. And I'm waiting to find out that.
The analysis involves sampling a small section of the boy's leg bone. Wolfram is particularly interested in the relative values of isotopes of nitrogen and carbon found in the collagen part of the bone. Called stable isotope testing, this process can reveal crucial information about a person's background.
Largely, it can say, where does someone come from? It can then tell us perhaps something about their diet, what sort of diet they had, were they herbivores, were they carnivores, was it a mixture of that? And when you know the diet, then that gives you some indication of a social status as well. So really those are the three things: the geography, where the person comes from, a bit about the diet, and then we can infer from that maybe a bit of the social status.
While Wolfram hunts for answers, Britain's finest unit for forensic investigation is embarking on a new and groundbreaking mission. They're experts in human identification using the full arsenal of modern technology. But now, for the first time, they're applying these skills to bodies from the long distant past.
It's very exciting for us to be able to take the skills that we use on a daily basis and apply them to look at historical skeletons to see just how far we can go.
Forensic anthropology, facial reconstruction, and painstaking research will open new windows on history as dramatic personal stories emerge from long forgotten bones.
Historical research is allowing me to investigate people's experiences at different times throughout history.
He certainly had a nasty crack to the top of his head.
That must have been so painful.
So we've got the face, the facial reconstruction, and we've added some textures.
Fantastic. That is just superb.
This time, the cold case team is heading back into a dark corner of the 19th century, when corpses were turned into trophies and children were sold by the inch. Oh,
this is really horrible.
Yes.
Their subject, the strange mummified skeleton of a child. Its brain has been removed, its blood vessels filled with wax. A child who deserved a better fate. Can they give him back a home, a face, a name? This is History Cold Case. The Centre for Anatomy and Human Identification, part of the University of Dundee. The forensic unit is about to take on a challenging new case surrounding an extraordinary set of human remains, the mummified skeleton of a child. Its identity is a mystery. For Professor Sue Black, leader of the cold case team, this is much more than just a set of bones. It's the start of the story. With her colleague, Dr. Xanthi Mallet, she begins with the first observation of the body.
Boy to look at.
Isn't he lovely?
He's beautiful.
The skeleton was donated by a colleague. Sue thinks it's over 100 years old and is some sort of anatomical specimen, dissected for the purposes of display.
A very good friend said, you know, I brought you a present. And I thought, well, you know, chocolates would have been nice.
Whiskey
would have
been nicer.
Would have been fine, but, you know, this is what we get as a present. Probably a little boy, somewhere around about 8. And I have to say, I've never seen anything like it before. No, I really haven't. No.
Transform the body, the top half of the skull has been sawn off and the chest prized open to remove internal organs. But some of the blood vessels are still preserved, carefully filled with a waxy resin.
Is he naturally mummified?
No, I don't think so. Because what you can, if you can see, these red bits that are sort of poking out here, these are resin. And this is a process that's called perfusion, where you place a substance into a vessel to make it stand out so that you can see it.
Until well into the 19th century, anatomists and surgeons commonly dissected and preserved human bodies as part of their training.
Okay, so that's
a specimen like this one could have been used as a teaching aid.
But look at the cross, look at the flow and the line of that.
Yeah.
They're very artistic. And when you hold them, lift them up, it's really quite...
It's pretty solid, isn't it?
Well, it is, but it's really rather impressive that that's how he would be hanging, looking like that.
Sue never forgets that her subjects were once living people.
There is a sadness in the case. There is no doubting there is a sadness. This was somebody's son. This little boy did have a mum. Whether he had a dad at home or not, we don't know, but he certainly would have had some family. But did anybody care enough when this happened to him? We don't know. I need to know who he is. I need to find that out. He needs that respect.
The initial examination confirms only the basic facts. He's a boy, probably around 8 years old. But can the cold case team discover anything about who he was, where he came from, when he lived, and of course, how he came to be hanging on a wall as some macabre display? Sue calls the first briefing.
Yep. This is what's been rather affectionately become known as the problem child of our department. So it's a little boy between 6 and 8.
Dr. Wolfram Meyer-Augenstein will hunt for chemical signatures in the boy's bones, which could reveal information about where he lived and what kind of life he had. Dr. Caroline Wilkinson will perform the important task of giving the boy back his face.
Is there enough face there for you to do something with?
Yeah.
Yeah? What about the fact that there's still some soft tissue on a nose and his ears are still there?
Yeah.
Oh, are they?
You can see one of the... Yeah. They're really you can really see one of the blood vessels.
Sue thinks the red wax found in the boy's blood vessels could provide crucial physical clues in the case.
This resin, this wax, when you mould it, so if you take a little bit out, you put it in your fingers and you smell it. My father was a cabinet maker, so constant smell of linseed oil and waxes and those sorts of things. It smells like the inside of my father's furniture van. So it must be oils or wax of some kind.
Xanthi's task is to get out on the road, to gather evidence from historical records and experts in other fields, starting with the history of anatomy.
But where do you get a 7-year-old, 8-year-old boy from? At what point in history have we got access to children that we could do that to? And my mind's automatically taken back to when the anatomists had access to bodies that were coming to the anatomy departments from the poorhouses.
Meanwhile, in Dundee, Sue and her student Scott use some of the ingredients to actually recreate the waxy resin from an 18th century recipe. They're cooking up a mixture of beeswax, pine resin, and turpentine. It may be the first time this has been done in a couple of centuries.
Perhaps if we do it very gently.
Gently.
Yeah. So that it's a slow and gradual process. And then at the very last minute, what we're going to do is put the vermilion in. Oh, look. Oh, it does actually look very like blood. You can see why they've used that, can't you?
Thomas Pohl's book of 1790 also advises on the best sort of body to use.
And it says, for this purpose, which is injecting, adult subjects are seldom used. Oh, how interesting. On the account of the difficulty in completely filling the vessels with injection. So the suggestion there is that to do this article, it's normally done on children.
Sue isn't content with just making up a recipe. She wants to inject it into a blood vessel and see how it works. In this case, it's a pig's aorta from a local butcher's.
If we try and suck it up, okay. It is a bit. If you can leave that, if you can hold up the aorta, let's see if we can inject it in. Now watch, because it might be quite hot. Let's just try. Oh, we can get a flow going.
Feel that hardening quite a bit towards the bottom.
Excellent. Yeah. Not burning your fingers that, is it?
No.
In terms of the injection, that's not going to take much more because it's right at the top there.
Yeah, push some more down.
And then it says, yep, it says put it in cold water then.
Okay.
Which is what's supposed to solidify.
I don't think it'll need much help, to be honest.
No. It's quite hard. Yeah, it's quite hard. If you take a plug of it out, for example, look. That's the sort of thing that we were finding inside his blood vessels. It does work.
The last of the forensic tests are now in, so Sue assembles the team. Wolfram has drawn a blank in terms of pinpointing where the boy comes from, but has found something exciting from the nitrogen values in the bone sample.
cut a long story short, all the nitrogen values point at somebody who had definitely not a protein deficient diet. Whether the protein came from lots of cheese and whatever, cream cheese or lots of milk, I don't know. Or whether it came from meat or fish or poultry, but it was definitely not meat deficient.
This is not a pauper's diet, is it?
Unless the diet in almshouses and pauper's houses was much better than we give them credit for.
No.
Such a protein-rich diet means our child is unlikely to have lived and died in a workhouse. And it would follow unlikely to have been the victim of the 1832 Anatomy Act. The stunted growth that Sue discovered in his bones could have been a result of disease. No one was immune to the epidemics like whooping cough and measles that raged through the population. The news that our boy was well nourished means Caroline can press on with recreating his face.
From my point of view, in terms of the amount of tissue depth we can use for the facial reconstruction, then the best thing for me to do is to use the average. There's no point in using emaciated.
No.
It's now time for Xanthi to drop her own bombshell. She's got the data back from the tests on the resin in the boy's blood vessels.
We sourced a sample of the Barclay collection and the Hunter collection so that
they
actually could
they
compare
gave you
them.
A sample of
yes.
That. Good grief.
Yes.
Mm. Well done.
So we had more than just the recipe to go on because there would have been some variation as people kind of tweaked it, just like any recipe.
Absolutely. So the Hunter material's all in London?
London.
The Barclay material?
Edinburgh. Okay. Yes. Right. So out of the two that they were compared to, it was Hunter that was the closest.
Good grief.
But it was close enough that it could have been a slight variation on Hunter's own recipe. So, I mean, long shot, but it could have been on Hunter himself that did the actual dissection.
So when you go to the Hunterian Museum,
yeah.
Is there something else that matches this?
Comparable, no.
So that what you could be looking at, for argument's sake, if we were absolutely going to take this to the limit,
is the first and only
example belonging to the Hunterian collection.
Mm.
Yeah,
of
surviving.
This kind of a presentation.
Yeah, possibly.
Outrageous.
Yes.
That makes it very, very important.
Yeah.
So our boy could be one of the first examples of this kind of specimen. And the result that his resin is similar to one of John Hunter's recipes would place our boy in a time well before the 1832 Anatomy Act made obtaining bodies legal.
We're looking at late 18th century, early 19th century, in London,
yeah. An
anatomical specimen,
yeah. A
child that's not particularly undernourished. We're not looking at a poorhouse child.
No.
What's happening in London on the anatomical scene at that time?
Before the Anatomy Act.
Before the Anatomy Act.
There was no legal way of obtaining children.
Was it illegal?
Well,
that's the question. You need to speak to somebody who has a good understanding of the anatomical society within London of that time, a good historian.
If our boy was illegally sourced to be experimented on, this is a major turning point.
What's happening in this case is that we've thought this is going to be a post-1832. No, it's not. It's a pre-1832. Completely different set of evidence, completely different path that we want to go down. So you can't predict when something is going to change, and this case has given us quite a number of twists and turns that we just simply couldn't have anticipated.
Does a boy, well-nourished and from London, point to an even darker side of the history of anatomy? Is he a victim of a period when the demand for dead bodies far outstripped the legal supply? When the grave robber was society's bogeyman. Xanthi's about to find out. She's back in London at the Royal College of Surgeons, where she's discovered that they have first-hand evidence that bodies like our boy's were stolen. She's meeting archivist Louise King.
Okay, so this is a diary of a resurrectionist from 1811 to 1812. It just covers a few months.
And resurrectionist would have been?
A grave robber, essentially.
Okay. February 2nd,
went to lookout, met at 5 in the evening, went to the green, got 7 large and 3 small and 3 fetus. Same night, went to Wisegate, something like that, Wygate, yeah. 4 large and 2 small, took them to Bartholomew's. So he's going and basically digging up graves, taking 7 large, so 7 adults, I guess, or 7 large children. No, I think large he tends to use for adults. Yeah.
3 children and 3 fetuses. Yeah. So he's looking probably for newly buried, newly covered graves.
I mean, as I understand it, they had lookouts who would let them know that there'd been burials.
A new burial and what was potentially being buried.
Yeah.
So it's almost like a shopping list.
Yeah.
And then taking them to hospitals for the dissection.
That's right, yes.
Wow. And this is the only book of its kind like this?
As far as we know, yes, it is.
Oh, how odd, isn't it? Just saying, like, 7 large and 3 small.
Yeah.
Oh.
It's a fantastic piece of evidence. But this diary is just one man's account. To find out more, Xanthi must immerse herself in the world of the resurrectionist. Will she be able to place our boy in this dark and largely unexplored chapter of British history? In Dundee, armed with the information that the boy had a healthy diet, Caroline is beginning the process of adding flesh to the bone.
I've placed these pegs on that represent the tissue depths. Now, because we found out that this individual wasn't emaciated, didn't have a starvation diet, we've used contemporary 7-8-year-old measurements from a British population. And that really helps us, after we've done the muscle structure, to put the correct amount of tissue over and above the muscles. So the next thing is to import each of the facial muscles and distort it and deform it to fit this particular skull.
Caroline uses haptic or tactile technology that allows her to mimic the experience of building a face from clay. A mechanical arm gives her the sensation of feeling the surface of the head she's reconstructing.
When you touch something on the computer screen, it gives you this what's called haptic feedback. So in other words, you can feel what you're touching on the screen. It enables you to do things with speed, but also look back at what's underneath as well, which is something you can't do with real clay. Once you put a muscle in place, you can't then have a look at the bone underneath again. So this system allows you to constantly check what you've done. So it's kind of exciting working with new technology like this.
Having placed all the muscles, she can now add the tissue. Everything she's done so far is based on the scientific information the team has gathered.
I'd say that the areas where there's most artistic interpretation will be the final additions related to age and texture and colour and hair and all those details that we don't know from the skull.
The facial reconstruction is almost complete. Caroline is on the verge of showing us the face of our boy. In London, Xanthi's digging deeper into the sordid history of the grave robbers. She's come to the very heart of the city to meet author Sarah Wise, who spent 5 years researching the world of the resurrectionist.
What I'm hoping that Sarah might be able to give me some insight into is how common this was. I mean, if she's got any information which could help us, that's what I'm hoping for. And just lead us down that path towards learning more about his identity, really.
Sarah wants to show Xanthi a London street that runs from the Old Bailey to Smithfield Market. This was the centre for a lucrative trade in fresh corpses driven by demand from nearby medical schools. Every student going through the schools needed at least one body to practice on, so the demand was high. Some of the corpses were mummified for display.
So why have we come here specifically?
This whole stretch really was the centre of the resurrection trade north of the river in London in the early 19th century.
I'm just going to take you up here and show you St Sepulchre's Church. And in 1791, they were so worried about the amount of bodies that were going missing from the graveyard that used to be over the back, that they did what many people, even in small villages, they'd club together and by themselves construct a watch house. So this watch house looked out over onto the graveyard of St Sepulchre, which was at the back.
So specifically to stop the resurrectionists coming in and selling
bodies.
That's right.
But unfortunately, a watch house was really only as useful as the man who was running it. And one of the other reasons that body snatching was able to flourish for so long was that a lot of the sextons, the watchmen, were corrupt and for significant payments would, well, not just turn a blind eye, but would open the gates and help.
That's really grim, isn't it?
It's really vile. It's absolutely horrible.
Across the road is the reason why this graveyard was particularly at risk.
So over on the right, we've got St Bartholomew's Hospital, which was one of the largest teaching hospitals in London, and very much in need of as many bodies that the body snatchers could supply them with. So much so that they would the porters would leave hampers, large hampers, outside or within their courtyard for the snatchers to run over, pick up the hamper in order to bring their corpses from here over to there. Because this was the site of the Fortune of War pub, which was the major meeting place and safe house for body snatchers north of the river.
All that remains now is a chilling inscription.
The landlord used to show the room where, on benches round the walls, the bodies were placed, labelled with the snatchers' names, wait until the surgeons at St Bartholomew's could run round and appraise them. Oh, wow. This was not exactly, you know, underground then, was it? This was...
It was very out in the open.
So this was a good, lucrative trade.
Very much so.
But was our boy simply stolen from a graveyard? Or was his fate even darker? In Edinburgh, historian Owen Dudley Edwards is showing Xanthi a chilling example of a place where corpses of the poor were taken.
We have to be very careful here. Mm-hmm. Very slowly.
This is very dark down here.
Isn't it? Isn't it nice?
Nice?
He's taking Xanthi into what was once a secret tunnel underneath the University of Edinburgh where dead bodies were brought in under the cover of night.
Early 19th centuries.
So this is where they would have been snuck in, basically?
Yes, well, the fact was that there was great hostility among the ordinary people of the city, because they believed the doctors were killing the poor to cure the diseases of the rich. So this tunnel existed, and the bodies would be taken in secretly by night on the ground that, as it were, what the crowd didn't know wouldn't trouble them.
Despite public hostility, it seems that the harvesting of bodies was all perfectly above board. In 1832, the government had passed the Anatomy Act, which made it legal for anatomists to claim any unclaimed corpse from the workhouse. But is our boy's story really so simple? Was he donated to an anatomist for dissection under the chilling edicts of the 1832 Anatomy Act? Xanthi is following a new lead to London. The historical picture that's beginning to emerge for the boy is pulling her deeper into his story.
You're dealing with forensic cases. All your training tells you to remain objective and to actively not engage with the person you're looking at and their history and their story. But we're getting to know the little mummified boy a little bit more now. So you find yourself wondering how he would have lived, and you're engaging with him on a personal level.
Xanthi is heading to the Hunterian Museum in London, home to Britain's largest collection of human and animal specimens. Simon Chaplin is showing her an extraordinary set of exhibits.
We're surrounded. There's 3,500 specimens here. These are all the work of John Hunter.
And John Hunter was an anatomist, obviously did a lot of dissection.
He was an anatomist, he was a surgeon, he was a teacher of surgery and anatomy, but he also had a much wider interest in natural history.
John Hunter was an 18th century celebrity who entertained the London elite in his salon in Leicester Square. He was so influential, the Bishop of Durham donated his own rectum to the collection. Some of Hunter's preservations were mummified, others pickled in alcohol, like this rare specimen of an unborn horse. But Simon Chaplin let slip something that could really shake up the investigation.
This is our little boy. Here you go.
The pose in this one is unusual. The raised hand is something that occurs quite often, and it harks back to earlier anatomical textbooks.
Oh, that's interesting. We haven't found anything about the position of the hand yet, and that's one of the things we thought was probably really key about this individual, so that's really probably an earlier specimen.
Well, it reminds me of 17th and early 18th century anatomical textbooks, where anatomical figures were often shown with one hand raised in a kind of classical pose.
Could this be evidence that our boy in fact lived before sourcing bodies for dissection was made legal by the Anatomy Act of 1832? More clues lie in a book by John Hunter's brother, William, from 1784, which points to how widespread the appetite was for human specimens.
And he says here, "I must likewise earnestly recommend it to every student to make and collect as many anatomical preparations as he can." And he goes on to say what preparations, what specimens, a student to have. And he says they should have a preparation of all of the blood vessels in their natural situation and two preparations of the trunk of a child. In other words, exactly the kind of preparation that we've been looking
at. Absolutely, yeah.
What Simon reveals is just how sought after these specimens were before the Anatomy Act made the supply of corpses legal. And they could fetch huge sums.
Well, I want to show you some of an amazing collection of auction catalogues from the late 18th, early 19th century.
Okay.
And what we have here is the catalogue of anatomical preparations, the property of a surgeon who has declined lecturing in about 1769. And if we look down here, we can see a whole subject in a wainscot case glazed with the arteries completely injected and dissected, and then lot 67, a child with the arteries injected, which sold, according to the annotation here, for £6.
If he'd been sold today, our boy could have fetched £8,500. In life, he might just have been a boy with a bleak future ahead of him, but in death, he could have been a very valuable commodity. Back in Dundee, Caroline begins the painstaking job of reconstructing the child's face. She's reconstructed the faces of the dead from Ramses II to Bach. But the boy represents a new and different challenge.
The first thing that I'll do when I look at facial reconstruction is to go through and make records, take measurements,
specifically with this one, I want to try and establish which is the soft tissue and which is the hard tissue, because that's quite difficult to see on the CT data, especially around the nose where we've got quite a lot of preserved, mummified soft tissues. I think it can be important to try and see this as a living person, because obviously there's been quite a lot of dissection that's been taking place, and there's been quite a lot of conservation of the tissues. And one of the nice things about doing a reconstruction is we should be able to see him as a living individual again. And that will as well give him back some dignity, because obviously this is relatively undignified.
It will take several more weeks before Caroline can fully reconstruct his face. At a team debrief, Xanthi updates the others about her discovery. She thinks that the anatomical books from London and the mummified children in Edinburgh could point to the boy being a much earlier specimen than they first thought.
To find out more about him, went over to the Royal College of Surgeons Museum.
Which one?
Edinburgh. And what we found was they have a number of mummified children over there.
Oh, do they?
Yeah, and this is one of them. And this is a little child. He's probably, I would say, 2 to 3 years old. These are pre the Anatomy Act.
Good heavens.
Everything will depend on forensic tests to pin down an accurate date for our boy. The results of radiocarbon dating a sample of the boy's leg bone proved inconclusive. But could they gain any information from analysing a sample of the waxy resin found in his blood vessels?
So are we saying there's a possibility of getting almost like a signature out of the resin?
Possibly.
That could match you to the person who did it?
Mm-hmm.
That's interesting.
Which is going to be the next stage.
It's a long shot. A small sample of resin will be subjected to mass spectrometry to decipher its chemical makeup. At the Hunterian Museum in London, Simon Chaplin has offered to donate a sample of resin from one of John Hunter's own specimens to see how it compares with the resin in our boy.
Okay.
Yeah, this is an ox heart from John Hunter's collection, so from the 18th century. It's been injected. Well, we've found that these extrusions are still quite pliable, and we've taken two specimens here for testing.
Xanthi also needs to pinpoint the ingredients used in the various recipes for resin developed by anatomists. Simon provides the first piece of the jigsaw in a 220-year-old book.
Here we have, is Thomas Pohl's Anatomical Instructor, published in 1790. And then here, what we have is the recipe for a coarse injection, to make a red coarse injection, the kind
exactly,
you would need for injecting
exactly
the blood vessels.
Exactly, using our mummified child, okay?
Yellow beeswax, 16 ounces. White resin, 8 ounces. Turpentine varnish, 6 ounces. Vermilion, 3 ounces. And these were very expensive artist pigments that they were using.
Oh, I see. Oh, OK, so these would have been readily available to most people. If expensive ingredients, they still would have been available to the students and the doctors.
They just would have gone along to a colour shop, the kind of place that sold artist supplies, and they would have bought them there.
Oh, I see. Oh, fantastic.
More research leads to 15 different recipes for resin. The 15 recipes share 13 common ingredients. And she's found an artist supply shop which still stocks the ingredients used by anatomists 2 centuries ago. She's meeting colour man Nicholas Wold.
I'm not sure how you'd say that. Isinglass?
Isinglass.
Isinglass.
Yes, fish glue.
Fish glue?
Fish glue.
Okay.
It comes from the bladder of sturgeon.
Okay. Also, yellow beeswax. Oh, wow. Actual little pellets. Oh, it's definitely beeswax, isn't it? So that's our vermilion.
That's a wonderful colour. It's a poisonous pigment.
What does carmine look like? Wow.
which again is an absolutely stunning colour.
Really vibrant, isn't it? Paraffin wax, Japan wax, all of these things.
Would definitely have been available.
Gamboy? Is it Gamboy?
Gamboge.
Gamboge. Oh, wow. Look at that. Oh.
Gamdamar, which is used for making varnish.
Okay.
That one.
Thank you very much.
Armed with all the ingredients, Xanthi can now organise the chemical analysis of our boy's resin. The results might just be able to pinpoint when and where he was originally preserved. In Dundee, our child's face is beginning to come back to life.
Well, the first thing we needed to do, obviously, was to add the missing bit of the cranium. And what we've done there is we've taken in a template of a similar aged and ethnicity skull that we already have in our database, and have morphed that to fit this skull, to fit with the contours of this skull. What I've also done is to copy the missing area of the supraorbital bone on the right-hand side and flipping it and putting it above the right orbit. Also, just because it looks a little strange, I filled the hole that's on the frontal bone on the forehead there, which was a mounting hole.
With the skull complete, Caroline can start adding some of the facial features.
Now, with the eyeballs, we can import spheres of approximately the right size, which is about 22 millimetres in diameter for someone of this age. In order to recreate the nose, I've taken measurements of the width of the nose and some measurements of the nasal aperture. So what I've then been able to do is to import a nose model and alter it to fit this particular skull. And we can also see in profile that we use those two tangents to tell us the most projecting point on the nose. We can see by the angle of them that this individual would have a concave nasal root, which means a curve, an upward curve to the nose, which is also very common in individuals of this age. Most children have little upturned noses. I think you can start to see what he's going to look like. So as soon as we start to see some of his facial features, then we can look at him as a boy rather than a specimen.
Caroline now needs the results of Wolfram's stable isotope tests, which could confirm the theory that the child was malnourished.
It doesn't give us any information about facial features. It won't make any difference to the shape of the face, but what it will do is enable us to choose which tissue depth data to use, whether to use emaciated, normal, or overweight. And I'm waiting to find out that.
The analysis involves sampling a small section of the boy's leg bone. Wolfram is particularly interested in the relative values of isotopes of nitrogen and carbon found in the collagen part of the bone. Called stable isotope testing, this process can reveal crucial information about a person's background.
Largely, it can say, where does someone come from? It can then tell us perhaps something about their diet, what sort of diet they had, were they herbivores, were they carnivores, was it a mixture of that? And when you know the diet, then that gives you some indication of a social status as well. So really those are the three things: the geography, where the person comes from, a bit about the diet, and then we can infer from that maybe a bit of the social status.
While Wolfram hunts for answers about the boy's diet, Xanthi continues her mission. Now armed with a third sample of resin from the Edinburgh mummies prepared by John Barclay, she's come to Northumbria University, where all three samples of resin will be tested.
Hi.
Hi.
Pleased to meet you at last.
I was hoping you can tell me a little bit about the waxy resin that we took out from the mummified child through his arterial system.
The 13 ingredients she picked up in the artist's supply shop will provide the baseline samples for the mass spectrometer. Britain's finest unit for forensic investigation is embarking on a new and groundbreaking mission. They're experts in human identification using the full arsenal of modern technology. But now, for the first time, they're applying these skills to bodies from the long, distant past.
It's very exciting for us to be able to take the skills that we use on a daily basis and apply them to look at historical skeletons to see just how far we can go.
Forensic anthropology, facial reconstruction, and painstaking research will open new windows on history as dramatic personal stories emerge from long forgotten bones.
Historical research is allowing me to investigate people's experiences at different times throughout history.
He certainly had a nasty crack to the top of his head.
That must have been so painful.
So we've got the face, the facial reconstruction, and we've added some textures.
Fantastic. Yeah. That is just super.
This time, the cold case team is heading back into a dark corner of the 19th century, when corpses were turned into trophies and children were sold by the inch. Oh,
this is just really horrible.
Yes.
Their subject, the strange mummified skeleton of a child. Its brain has been removed, its blood vessels filled with wax. A child who deserved a better fate. Can they give him back a home, a face, a name? This is History Cold Case. The Centre for Anatomy and Human Identification, part of the University of Dundee. The forensic unit is about to take on a challenging new case surrounding an extraordinary set of human remains, the mummified skeleton of a child. Its identity is a mystery. For Professor Sue Black, leader of the cold case team, this is much more than just a set of bones. It's the start of the story. With her colleague, Dr. Xanthi Mallet, she begins with the first observation of the body.
Boy to look at.
Isn't he lovely?
He's beautiful.
The skeleton was donated by a colleague. Sue thinks it's over 100 years old and is some sort of anatomical specimen, dissected for the purposes of display.
A very good friend said, you know, I brought you a present. And I thought, well, you know, chocolates would have been nice.
Whiskey
would have
been nicer.
Would have been fine, but, you know, this is what we get as a present. Probably a little boy, somewhere around about 8. And I have to say, I've never seen anything like it before. No, I really haven't. No.
To transform the body, the top half of the skull has been sawn off and the chest prized open to remove internal organs. But some of the blood vessels are still preserved, carefully filled with a waxy resin.
Is he naturally mummified?
No, I don't think so. Because what you can, if you can see, these red bits that are sort of poking out here, these are resin. And this is a process that's called perfusion, where you place a substance into a vessel to make it stand out so that you can see it.
Until well into the 19th century, anatomists and surgeons commonly dissected and preserved human bodies as part of their training.
Okay, so that's
a specimen like this one could have been used as a teaching aid.
But look at the cross, look at the flow and the line of that.
Yeah.
They're very artistic. And when you hold them, lift them up, it's really quite...
It's pretty solid, isn't it?
Well, it is, but it's really rather impressive that that's how he would be hanging, looking like that.
Sue never forgets that her subjects were once living people.
There is a sadness in the case. There is no doubting there is a sadness. This was somebody's son. This little boy did have a mum. Whether he had a dad at home or not, we don't know, but he certainly would have had some family. But did anybody care enough when this happened to him? We don't know. I need to know who he is. I need to find that out. He needs that respect.
The initial examination confirms only the basic facts. He's a boy, probably around 8 years old. But can the cold case team discover anything about who he was, where he came from, when he lived, and of course, how he came to be hanging on a wall as some macabre display? Sue calls the first briefing.
This is what's been rather affectionately become known as the problem child of our department. So it's a little boy between 6 and 8.
Dr. Wolfram Meyer-Augenstein will hunt for chemical signatures in the boy's bones, which could reveal information about where he lived and what kind of life he had. Dr. Caroline Wilkinson will perform the important task of giving the boy back his face.
Is there enough face there for you to...
Yeah.
Do something okay. with.
Yeah.
Yeah? What about the fact that there's still some soft tissue on a nose and his ears are still there?
Yeah.
Oh, are they?
You can see one of the... Yeah.
They're really
You can see one of the blood vessels.
Sue thinks the red wax found in the boy's blood vessels could provide crucial physical clues in the case.
This resin, this wax... When you mould it, so if you take a little bit out, you put it in your fingers and you smell it. My father was a cabinet maker, so constant smell of linseed oil and waxes and those sorts of things. It smells like the inside of my father's furniture van. So it must be oils or wax of some kind.
Xanthi's task is to get out on the road, to gather evidence from historical records and experts in other fields, starting with the history of anatomy.
But where do you get... a 7-year-old, 8-year-old boy from? At what point in history have we got access to children that we could do that to? And my mind's automatically taken back to when the anatomists had access to bodies that were coming to the anatomy departments from the poorhouses.
Bizarre as it seems to us today, Sue knows that the display of human bodies was once considered perfectly acceptable.
If I'm going to put money on any of this, I could see him late 1800s, even into the early 1900s.
The cold case investigation will focus on three key areas. The history. Where does our boy fit into the strange story of human dissection? The body. They will do stable isotope analysis on his bones and test a sample of resin used to preserve his blood vessels. And facial reconstruction will hopefully give him back his identity. Xanthi's first stop will be a museum collection she's heard may have some specimens that could shed light on the boy's story.
I've no idea really whether he's literally one in his own or whether there are more like him somewhere. So I'm going to go to Edinburgh and see if I can find some evidence as to how unique he might be.
Edinburgh's Surgeons Hall Museum has housed artefacts belonging to the Royal College of Surgeons in Scotland since 1804. Here, Xanthi's meeting curator Andrew Connell, who wants to show her a bizarre collection donated by the pioneering Scottish anatomist, John Barclay.
Oh, look at that. Oh, wow. Now that is a young child.
Now these are from the Barclay collection. John Barclay donated his collection to the college.
Beautifully done. Look at that, all the tiny vessels.
Yeah.
Is it possible to pick him up? Is he very delicate?
If you like to put on a pair of gloves and almost, almost baby-like if you just support him under his spine at the back.
Yeah.
On his death in 1826, Berkeley left more than 2,500 specimens, some of them children, just like our cold case.
It's quite beautiful, isn't it?
In its own way.
Again, the soft tissue of the face has been left intact, hasn't it? The nose and ears, primarily, in this case. Yeah. He's amazing as well.
Many of these specimens have waxy resin in their blood vessels, just like our boy. There's one exhibit in particular that catches Xanthi's attention.
Oh, wow. He's really, really interesting, very similar to our boy, except he's got less soft tissue on his face, but visually he's very similar. Do you want me to show you our mummified boy?
Sure, if you wanted to display a particular posture.
There we are, that's our young man.
Let's have a look at the window here. Right. Well, certainly I can see similarities between them.
I think in terms of when he would have been dissected and naturally mummified, that might be quite a similar match. 1702. Wow.
So, the Dundee case isn't the only surviving specimen of children whose bodies were turned into exhibits. But confirming the date and provenance of the Dundee mummy will involve a lot of hard science. For Sue, the next step is to take detailed measurements of the child's bones. And something doesn't add up.
What I think is happening here is that the top half of the body, the teeth and the collarbone, are telling me this is a child of about 8. The other parts of the body, so the long bones, are telling me that if this was a normal child, then they're going to be much younger, they're going to be 5. I can't believe those. Those are going to be wrong. He's got short little limbs, short little legs and short little arms, simply because there's been some disturbance. There's something going on.
The boy is several centimetres shorter than he should be for his age. To see if she can discover why, Xanthi arranges for him to be scanned at a hospital just up the road.
Charlie, good?
The remains of a mummified child aren't what they're used to. The CT scanner takes a series of x-rays that can be built up into a three-dimensional picture, allowing us to see inside the child's bones. The data will hopefully reveal why the boy is significantly stunted in stature, as well as forming the starting point for Caroline's facial reconstruction.
Oh, look at that.
Huh. There you go.
Wow.
With the scan complete, the images of the boy's leg bones provide Sue with a big clue about events in his early life.
I've got on here now the foot and the lower end of the tibia and the fibula, which is just down at the ankle joint. And that very dense white line is where the bone is growing. But if you look above it, you can see just a ghostly white line that runs across above that. And there's another one above it, and another one above it, and again, and again. These are the Harris lines. And what they tell us is that when that bone was growing, for whatever reason, it went into a stutter. And so that rather than laying down bone and getting bigger, it's gone into a stutter and it leaves behind a line of dense white bone. And this is telling us that this child has gone through episodes of either malnutrition or episodes of disease or something that will affect his growth. And it would be very easy to fit that picture into the workhouses of the 1800s, very, very easily. It's really rather sad, isn't it?
These Harris lines tell us that his bones stopped growing more than once during his childhood. If he was among those living in the workhouses set up in the 1830s, he could easily have lived in squalid conditions, barely surviving on starvation rations. Many who entered the workhouse died, and shocking as it may seem, the bodies often ended up on the anatomist's table. It would be a pitiful end for a small boy. But despite the emotional tug of the case, Sue has to keep her professional distance.
My job as a forensic scientist is to be able to provide objective evidence. If I become involved personally in the case, I start to have my own opinions that somebody should be found guilty, that somebody needs to pay for this, then I am no longer an objective scientist and I should be removed from that arena. As the problem child of our department. So it's a little boy between 6 and 8.
Dr. Wolfram Meyer-Augenstein will hunt for chemical signatures in the boy's bones, which could reveal information about where he lived and what kind of life he had. Dr. Caroline Wilkinson will perform the important task of giving the boy back his face.
Is there enough face there for you to do something with?
Yeah.
What about the fact that there's still some soft tissue on a nose and his ears are still there?
Yeah. Oh, are they?
You can see one of the one of the blood vessels.
Sue thinks the red wax found in the boy's blood vessels could provide crucial physical clues in the case.
This resin, this wax, when you mold it, so if you take a little bit out, you put it in your fingers and you smell it. My father was a cabinet maker. So constant smells of linseed oil and waxes and those sorts of things. It smells like the inside of my father's furniture van. So it must be oils or wax of some kind.
Xanthi's task is to get out on the road, to gather evidence from historical records and experts in other fields, starting with the history of anatomy.
But where do you get a 7-year-old, 8-year-old boy from? At what point in history have we got access to children that we could do that to? And my mind's automatically taken back to when the anatomists had access to bodies that were coming to the anatomy departments from the poorhouses.
Bizarre as it seems to us today, Sue knows that the display of human bodies was once considered perfectly acceptable.
If I'm going to put money on any of this, I could see him late 1800s, even into the early 1900s.
The cold case investigation will focus on three key areas. The history. Where does our boy fit into the strange story of human dissection? The body. They will do stable isotope analysis on his bones and test a sample of resin used to preserve his blood vessels. And facial reconstruction will hopefully give him back his identity. Xanthi's first stop will be a museum collection she's heard may have some specimens that could shed light on the boy's story.
I've no idea really whether he's literally one in his own or whether there are more like him somewhere. So I'm going to go to Edinburgh and see if I can find some evidence as to how unique he might be.
Edinburgh's Surgeons Hall Museum has housed artefacts belonging to the Royal College of Surgeons in Scotland since 1804. Here, Xanthi's meeting curator Andrew Connell, who wants to show her a bizarre collection donated by the pioneering Scottish anatomist, John Barclay.
Oh, look at that. Oh, wow. Now that is a young child.
Now these are from the Barclay collection. John Barclay donated his collection to the college.
Beautifully done. Look at that, all the tiny vessels.
Yeah.
Is it possible to pick him up? Is he very delicate?
If you like to put on a pair of gloves and almost baby-like if you just support him under his spine at the back.
Yeah.
On his death in 1826, Berkeley left more than 2,500 specimens, some of them children, just like our cold case.
Quite beautiful, isn't he?
Mm. In its own way.
Again, the soft tissue of the face has been left intact, hasn't it? The nose and ears, primarily, in this case. Yeah. He's amazing as well.
Many of these specimens have waxy resin in their blood vessels, just like our boy. There's one exhibit in particular that catches Xanthi's attention.
Oh, wow. He's really, really interesting, very similar to our boy, except he's got less soft tissue on his face, but visually he's very similar. Do you want me to show you our mummified boy?
So if you wanted to display a particular posture.
There we are, that's our young man.
Let's have a look at the window here. Right. Well, certainly I can see similarities between them.
I think, in terms of when he would have been dissected and naturally mummified, that might be quite a similar match. 1702. Wow.
So, the Dundee case isn't the only surviving specimen of children whose bodies were turned into exhibits. But confirming the date and provenance of the Dundee mummy will involve a lot of hard science. For Sue, the next step is to take detailed measurements of the child's bones. And something doesn't add up.
What I think is happening here is that the top half of the body, the teeth and the collarbone, are telling me this is a child of about 8. The other parts of the body, so the long bones, are telling me that if this was a normal child, then they're going to be much younger, they're going to be 5. I can't believe those. Those are going to be wrong. He's got short little limbs, short little legs and short little arms, simply because there's been some disturbance. There's something going on.
The boy is several centimetres shorter than he should be for his age. To see if she can discover why, Xanthi arranges for him to be scanned at a hospital just up the road.
Charlie, good?
The remains of a mummified child aren't what they're used to. The CT scanner takes a series of x-rays that can be built up into a three-dimensional picture, allowing us to see inside the child's bones. The data will hopefully reveal why the boy is significantly stunted in stature, as well as forming the starting point for Caroline's facial reconstruction.
Oh, look at that.
There you go.
Wow.
With the scan complete, the images of the boy's leg bones provide Sue with a big clue about events in his early life.
I've got on here now the foot and the lower end of the tibia and the fibula, which is just down at the ankle joint. And that very dense white line is where the bone is growing. But if you look above it, you can see just a ghostly white line that runs across above that. And there's another one above it, and another one above it, and again, and again. These are the Harris lines. And what they tell us is that when that bone was growing, for whatever reason, it went into a stutter. And so that rather than laying down bone and getting bigger, it's gone into a stutter and it leaves behind a line of dense white bone. And this is telling us that this child has gone through episodes of either malnutrition or episodes of disease or something that will affect his growth. And it would be very easy to fit that picture into the workhouses of the 1800s, very, very easily. It's really rather sad, isn't it?
These Harris lines tell us that his bones stopped growing more than once during his childhood. If he was among those living in the workhouses set up in the 1830s, he could easily have lived in squalid conditions, barely surviving on starvation rations. Many who entered the workhouse died, and shocking as it may seem, the bodies often ended up on the anatomist's table. It would be a pitiful end for a small boy. But despite the emotional tug of the case, Sue has to keep her professional distance.
My job as a forensic scientist is to be able to provide objective evidence. If I become involved personally in the case, I start to have my own opinions that somebody should be found guilty, that somebody needs to pay for this, then I am no longer an objective scientist and I should be removed from that arena.
In Edinburgh, historian Owen Dudley Edwards is showing Xanthi a chilling example of a place where corpses of the poor were taken.
Now, we have to be very careful here. Mm-hmm. Very slowly.
This is very dark down here.
Isn't it? Isn't it nice?
Nice?
He's taking Xanthi into what was once a secret tunnel underneath the University of Edinburgh where dead bodies were brought in under the cover of night.
Early 19th centuries.
So this is where they would have been snuck in, basically?
Yes, well, the fact was that there was great hostility among the ordinary people of the city because they believed the doctors were killing the poor to cure the diseases of the rich. So this tunnel existed, and the bodies would be taken in secretly by night on the ground that, as it were, what the crowd didn't know wouldn't trouble them.
Despite public hostility, it seems that the harvesting of bodies was all perfectly above board. In 1832, the government had passed the Anatomy Act, which made it legal for anatomists to claim any unclaimed corpse from the workhouse. But is our boy's story really so simple? Was he donated to an anatomist for dissection under the chilling edicts of the 1832 Anatomy Act? Xanthi is following a new lead to London. The historical picture that's beginning to emerge for the boy is pulling her deeper into his story.
You're dealing with forensic cases. All your training tells you to remain objective and to actively not engage with the person you're looking at and their history and their story. But we're getting to know the little mummified boy a little bit more now. So you find yourself wondering how he would have lived and you're engaging with him on a personal level.
Xanthi is heading to the Hunterian Museum in London, home to Britain's largest collection of human and animal specimens. Simon Chaplin is showing her an extraordinary set of exhibits.
We're surrounded. There's 3,500 specimens here. These are all the work of John Hunter.
And John Hunter was an anatomist, obviously did a lot of dissection.
He was an anatomist, he was a surgeon, he was a teacher of surgery and anatomy, but he also had a much wider interest in natural history.
John Hunter was an 18th century celebrity who entertained the London elite in his salon in Leicester Square. He was so influential, the Bishop of Durham donated his own rectum to the collection. Some of Hunter's preservations were mummified, others pickled in alcohol, like this rare specimen of an unborn horse. But Simon Chaplin let slip something that could really shake up the investigation.
This is our little boy. Here you go.
The pose in this one is unusual. The raised hand is something that occurs quite often, and it harks back to earlier anatomical textbooks.
Oh, that's interesting. We haven't found anything about the position of the hand yet, and that's one of the things we thought was probably really key about this individual, so that's really probably an earlier specimen.
Well, it reminds me of 17th and early 18th century anatomical textbooks, where anatomical figures were often shown with one hand raised in a kind of classical pose.
Could this be evidence that our boy in fact lived before sourcing bodies for dissection was made legal by the Anatomy Act of 1832? More clues lie in a book by John Hunter's brother, William, from 1784, which points to how widespread the appetite was for human specimens.
And he says here, "I must likewise earnestly recommend it to every student to make and collect as many anatomical preparations as he can." And he goes on to say what preparations, what specimens, a student to have, and he says they should have a preparation of all the blood vessels in their natural situation and two preparations of the trunk of a child. In other words, exactly the kind of preparation that we've been looking at.
Absolutely, yeah.
What Simon reveals is just how sought after these specimens were before the Anatomy Act made the supply of corpses legal. And they could fetch huge sums.
I wanted to show you some of an amazing collection of auction catalogues from the late 18th, early 19th century.
Okay.
And what we have here is the catalogue of anatomical preparations, the property of a surgeon who has declined lecturing, in about 1769. And if we look down here, we can see a whole subject in a wainscot case glazed with the arteries completely injected and dissected, and then lot 67, a child with the arteries injected, which sold, according to the annotation here, for £6.
If he'd been sold today, our boy could have fetched £8,500. In life, he might just have been a boy with a bleak future ahead of him, but in death, he could have been a very valuable commodity. In a former resurrectionist pub next to Smithfield Market, Sarah reveals just how far some body snatchers were willing to go.
I'd like to show you a document.
It's a confession taken the day before his execution from a very prolific body snatcher called John Bishop.
Oh.
The document explains how Bishop and his accomplice lured a 14-year-old boy from a Smithfield pub back to his house.
We lighted a candle and gave the boy some bread and cheese. And after he'd eaten, we gave him a cup full of rum with about half a small phial of laudanum in it. Is that...
That's a tincture of opium.
Yeah. Oh, OK. Was it illegal then?
Laudanum wasn't at all illegal. And in fact, many people in the 19th century used it quite openly and respectably as a sort of tonic or pick-me-up or, you know, some sort of relaxant.
The boy quickly passed out.
We took him directly, asleep and insensible, into the garden, tied a cord to his feet to enable us to pull him up by, and then I took him in my arms and let him slide from them headlong into the well in the garden, whilst Williams held the cord to prevent the body going altogether too low into the well. He was nearly wholly in the water of the well, his feet just above the surface. Williams fastened the other end of the cord around the paling to prevent the body getting beyond our reach. The boy struggled a little with his arms and legs in the water, and the water bubbled for a minute.
Oh, this just seems really horrible.
Yes. They tricked this little boy. They got him drunk, partially drunk. They drugged him. They drowned him.
Yes. And consequently, they had an extremely fresh body to start touting around to the surgeons the next morning, which is exactly what they did. And it's exactly what led to their arrest. Unfortunately, it was not the first time they'd behaved in that way. James May, who was his co-defendant at the Old Bailey, he shouted across to Bishop, "You're a bloody murdering bastard, and you should have been topped, i.e. hanged, years ago," which indicates strongly that May believed that Bishop had been murdering for years.
And the other strange thing, Xanathi, is that
the body was in fact noted, and the word that was used was stout.
Oh. This boy was not sort of emaciated. He hadn't gone hungry.
Oh, that is interesting. Wow.
Records prove that Bishop snatched up to 1,000 bodies, and he and his gang may have murdered many more than the 3 victims he confessed to in and around Smithfield Market. The panic unleashed by the Bishop case of 1831 highlighted the disappearance of thousands of children, many of them as young as our boy.
I had no idea that the area surrounding Smithfield Market, where all of the meat trades take part, this is the centre of the human meat trade. Children were being sourced here, literally for murder, to furnish the anatomists. And it's a shocking and horrifying end for these lives.
Whatever the fate of our 8-year-old child, once handed over to the anatomists, he quickly became faceless and anonymous. But the team is about to give him back his identity. The team's forensic evidence and historical research have revealed that our mummy is an 8-year-old boy who they believe died in London before the Anatomy Act of 1832, which made acquiring dead bodies legal. He was well nourished, but he had lived through periods of ill health. He was either a freshly buried corpse dug up by grave robbers, or he was murdered, like the boy in the Bishop confession.
He picked up this boy, took him home and killed him.
Yeah. Wait till he got a bit sleepy.
Yeah.
Chuck him in the well.
I just think it's getting more tragic as we go along this tale. It started out as an anatomical specimen and then we kind of realised it was, you know...
illegally obtained.
It was a boy and that it was may have been illegally obtained and now it's looking more likely it's a murder and...
opposite.
All for the sake of an anatomical specimen.
But that's anatomy's history.
I know, it's just this particular case. I didn't expect it to head in that direction.
But were you ever going to have a happy outcome with a dissected 7-year-old? Anatomy has a very, very murky past. And we know it's got a murky past. And ultimately, I think he's a representation of that murky past.
The time has come for Caroline to reveal the final piece of the jigsaw.
So we've got the face, the facial reconstruction, and we've taken that and added some textures. He's been given quite, not neutral, but common hair colour and eye colour, and references from that period of time in terms of hairstyle have been used.
OK, so this is just
a
still.
Very nice looking boy.
That's good. I like that.
But the reveal and the end of the investigation presents the team with a dilemma.
We've got to decide, I suppose, what we do with them now.
Yep.
And I think there are 3 choices that I can see. It remains in the department.
We've never been
under
with
circumstances
that.
Which I don't think are appropriate.
No. Okay, so that's
we ask the Hunterian Museum or whichever whether they would be prepared to house the specimen appropriately, but with a full story as to how this has unfolded,
Or we decide he goes back into the ground.
Maybe we have an opportunity here to educate people about that
darker
side.
Do you want him to
side?
Become an educational specimen?
Oh. Oh, now you make me sound really hard.
I don't like display cabinets. I never really have, I must admit. So if we have any doubt...
We bury him.
Then you bury him. Mm. Then I think our decision is that he should be buried.
Would you have felt the same before you saw his face?
Yes. Wouldn't have made any difference. Because I do feel very, very strongly about human remains. And I do feel very strongly about their display. And as an anatomist, I feel a responsibility.
After more than 170 years, the History Cold Case team has given our 8-year-old boy back his face and his dignity. For Sue, the case of the mummified child can now be closed.
I think the fact that in this case we've gone from something about which we knew absolutely nothing to a point now that we can almost pinpoint him down in time, that we know which anatomy house he's most closely related to, and we can start to place him within the context of that time. That's an incredible achievement in a very short space of time. And I must admit, it's not something that for a moment, if I'd been honest at the outset, I didn't think we were going to get very far. We have gone much, much further than I could ever have anticipated. This is just about as good as it gets.
Next time, we head back to medieval Scotland as the team try to piece together the identity of an extraordinary skeleton unearthed at Stirling Castle.
He certainly had a nasty crack to the top of his head.
It could be our man.
Yes.
Ooh,
it could
okay.
Be our man.
Britain's finest unit for forensic investigation is embarking on a new and groundbreaking mission. They're experts in human identification using the full arsenal of modern technology. But now, for the first time, they're applying these skills to bodies from the long distant past.
It's very exciting for us to be able to take the skills that we use on a daily basis and apply them to look at historical skeletons to see just how far we can go.
Forensic anthropology, facial reconstruction, and painstaking research will open new windows on history as dramatic personal stories emerge from long forgotten bones.
Historical research is allowing me to investigate people's experiences at different times throughout history.
He certainly had a nasty crack to the top of his head.
That must have been so painful.
So we've got the face, the facial reconstruction, and we've added some textures.
Fantastic. Yeah. That is just superb.
This time, the cold case team is heading back into a dark corner of the 19th century, when corpses were turned into trophies and children were sold by the inch.
This just seems really horrible.
Yes.
Their subject, the strange mummified skeleton of a child. Its brain has been removed, its blood vessels filled with wax. A child who deserved a better fate. Can they give him back a home, a face, a name? This is History Cold Case. The Centre for Anatomy and Human Identification, part of the University of Dundee. The forensic unit is about to take on a challenging new case surrounding an extraordinary set of human remains, the mummified skeleton of a child. Its identity is a mystery. For Professor Sue Black, leader of the cold case team, this is much more than just a set of bones. It's the start of the story. With her colleague, Dr. Xanthi Malich, she begins with the first observation of the body.
Boy to look at.
Isn't he lovely?
He's beautiful.
The skeleton was donated by a colleague. Sue thinks it's over 100 years old and is some sort of anatomical specimen, dissected for the purposes of display.
A very good friend said, you know, I brought you a present. And I thought, well, you know, chocolates would have been nice.
Whiskey,
you know, champagne
would have been,
fine, but, you know, this is what we get as a present. Probably a little boy, somewhere around about 8. And I have to say, I've never seen anything like it before. No. I really haven't. No.
To transform the body, the top half of the skull has been sawn off and the chest prized open to remove internal organs. But some of the blood vessels are still preserved, carefully filled with a waxy resin.
Is he naturally mummified?
No, I don't think so. Because what you can, if you can see, these red bits that are sort of poking out here, these are resin. And this is a process that's called perfusion, where you place a substance into a vessel to make it stand out so that you can see it.
Until well into the 19th century, anatomists and surgeons commonly dissected and preserved human bodies as part of their training.
Okay, so that's
a specimen like this one could have been used as a teaching aid.
But look at the cross. Look at the flow and the line of that.
Yeah.
They're very artistic. And when you hold them, lift them up, it's really quite...
It's pretty solid, isn't it?
Well, it is, but it's really rather impressive that that's how he would be hanging, looking like that.
Sue never forgets that her subjects were once living people.
There is a sadness in the case. There is no doubting there is a sadness. This was somebody's son. This little boy did have a mum. Whether he had a dad at home or not, we don't know, but he certainly would have had some family. But did anybody care enough when this happened to him? We don't know. I need to know who he is. I need to find that out. He needs that respect.
The initial examination confirms only the basic facts. He's a boy, probably around 8 years old. But can the cold case team discover anything about who he was, where he came from, when he lived, and of course, how he came to be hanging on a wall as some macabre display? Sue calls the first briefing.
This is what's been rather affectionately become known